Hello guys and welcome back to the channel. This is Ayush and from now we are going to start our the Linux shell scripting tutorial. Okay, so we will start with the basics to the advanced, and we will cover many concepts. Like we will cover like programming concepts like if else, for loops, and also we will create some scripts like automated scripts, and we will do some minor projects also. So now from this video, like in today's video, we will cover some basic concepts like what is a shell, what is a bash, and also we'll see how you can create your first script. That will be a very interesting thing. Okay, but before starting, let me tell you, like we use shell scripting mostly for the purpose of the automation. Okay, if you want to automate some kind of task, then you can use the shell scripting as an automation. Like not as an automation, you can say like shell, you can use the shell script as a tool to automate your work. Okay, so now first of all, now let's come to the point and we will learn about the what is a shell. Okay, so shell is nothing but you can say it's just like interface which provides you to write some codes and write some commands. So right now this terminal is using the bash shell. Okay, so but also according to the some other articles, some books, shell is just like an interpreter. Like it basically runs like executes the command line by line. Okay, so that is the work of the interpreter. Like it executes the code line by line, and if some error occurs, then it will just throw it on the screen. So shell is just also like an interpreter. It basically interprets the .sh files or .sh programs, you can say, or you can say the scripts. So now you will say what is a script. So a script is nothing but the like your program file. Just like in Python you create .py file, so similarly in shell scripting and or in bash scripting we create the .sh file. Okay, so why we say like shell acts like an interpreter? Because it interprets the .sh files or .sh programs, you can say. So I hope you got a fair idea about what is a shell. Okay, so now let's start with the basic concept, like what are the different types of shell in our Linux operating system. Okay, so there are many shells like bash shell and also like kbone shell, born again shell. Okay, so you can get the list of the shells in this particular directory. Not directly, it's a directory. Okay, so here you can see the multiple shells is being used or present in my this operating system. So for this whole series we will like stick with the only the second one, this one, bash is bash, that means born again shell. Okay, but this SH, the first one shell, was the first shell which was created by the Linux, and the next there is born again shell came into the role. So we will use the born again shell for our this entire series. And now what we have to do, we have to just create one single script of hello world. And also let me tell you the what is this bin. So the shell, your shell will be present in this bin directory. Okay, so now but before creating your first script, let me tell you the what script is being used by this session or by this terminal. So you need to just enter this echo and the shell, dollar shell, and here you can see the bash shell is being used. Okay, now what we have to do, we have to just create the first script, that is the hello world script. How we will do it, we will just I'll move on to the desktop and I'll create the cat hello world.sh. Why .sh? Because like we are creating the shell script, so bash script, that's why we are using the .sh extension. So here you can see the file has been created, hello.sh. Now I will use this /bin/bash. It's just like this line basically tells like tells our script or our the shell to which shell to use. Like tell the interpreter which shell to use. So here I am just defining, like I want to use the bash again shell, that is this one, bin bash, not sh. Okay, so now I can do echo. Echo is just like the print command. Okay, echo hello world, I'm learning bash scripting. This one, now hit Control D, and to run the script you need to add some permissions. So you cannot directly run the script. If you will check the permission for hello world.sh, so here you can see this is only read write permission, you cannot execute that script. So to give the particular permission to this particular file, you will need to just add the permission using the chmod. You will, if you will use plus x and the hello world.sh is the name of the file, so permission will get added, and here you will see the execution permission has been added and the color also has been changed from white to the green. Okay, now to execute, what you do, you have to just do dot slash and the name of the script, and we are done. So as you can see, our script has been executed successfully. Okay, so I hope you like this, guys, like how you can create the shell scripting, and also I hope you got to learn about the what is a shell, what is bash, and if not, then please go and you should explore yourself also to gain some kind of knowledge. Okay, so that's all for today, guys. We will meet you in the next video. Thank you for watching, and I will come up and meet you in the next video with some amazing concepts. Thank you. Hello guys, now in this particular video we will be installing the Visual Studio Code, because we will use this IDE to write our shell scripts. Okay, so let me tell you how you can install it in an easy way. So here is the Ubuntu software. From here you can install multiple softwares. Now you have to just search for the Visual Studio Code, and it will take some time to load. Let's wait. So, but before that, let me tell you about what is Visual Studio Code. So it's basically one of the IDE which we use to write our codes. You can write code in any language which you want, from C++ to Java, Python, everything. Okay, so here you can see the review is also good. Now we have to just click on this install. So it will take some time for installation. Let's wait. Okay, it is installed now. What now we have to do, we have to just click on this show applications, and here's just search for the VS Code or Visual Studio, it may be, yeah, here you can see the Visual Studio Code. We will just click on it and it will open up like this, and this is something okay. So here you can see you need to open some folder. Let me click on open folder, and on the desktop I want to create one folder, like plus I will create the shell scripting tutorial. Okay, just click on create and you're done. You have to just click on open. Don't save, I don't want, this is some kind of file. Okay, let's wait. I think the system is lagging because of the low RAM. Actually I'm running it in the Ubuntu machine, in VirtualBox, that's why it's happening like this. Now here I will create just one simple script, that is 01 test.sh. I will create, sorry, I have entered comma there. Again I will create 01 test.sh. okay, so here you need to add the shebang. This symbol is called shebang bin bash echo. You have to just write here hello world, and you are good to go. You have to just open up the terminal here, new terminal, and you will need to just add the permission for this particular file, that is 01 test.sh, and you need to just execute it dot slash 01 test.sh. Okay, let me just do ls, why it's not executing. Okay, /01 test.sh. why it's showing bad, no such file or directory. Okay, I think I have my mistake written like this. Okay, so here you can see hello world. Okay, so in this way we can write our scripts in this IDE and we can easily run it. Okay, so that's all for today's video, guys. I hope you successfully installed, and in our further videos we will start with the basic concepts of the shell scripting. So that's all for today's video, and I will meet you in the next one. Thank you for watching. Now in this video we will be learning about the what are the variables. Okay, so first of all let me tell you about the what are the topics which we will be covering in this particular video. So let me just open up the terminal and I will write all those topics which we'll be covering this particular video. So first of all we will cover variables, what are the variables, then user defined variables, and next environment variables. Okay, so these are the topics which we'll be covering in this particular video. So first of all let me start with the variables. Okay, what are the variables? Okay, but before that let me first open up my VS Code. Actually I have already done it here. You can see now you have to just create one file, that is 02 variables.sh. okay, so we will use .sh extension for creation of file, and I hope you have already installed this VS Code. Actually in our previous video we have covered this part of installation. So now what we have to do, you have to just enter this shebang, and then you have to just you are good to go. You can write any command here also, like you variables, you can write here variables. Okay, just save it, and here is the run button. If you run it, maybe it will run. Yeah, it's working fine. Okay, so now what we can do, let me tell you about first variables. What are the variables? Okay, so variables is nothing but just like a container. Okay, container which will hold some values. Okay, so variable is nothing but just like a container which will hold some kind of value. It may be integer, it may be a string, it can be your any kind of value, like your decimal value or character value. Okay, so these are the variables. Okay, so what happens actually, like internally, what are the what things happen? Okay, if you are coming from the C++ background, so you might be aware of those things. Like let me tell you all this. I will open up the paint so that will be easy to understand for you. Okay, so I will just create a block here. Okay, so what happens if you create a variable? Suppose you create a variable a equal to 10. Okay, so at that time what will happen, a block will be created in a memory and some address will be given to that. Okay, now you will tell ask me what are the address. So address is nothing but which is used to access those variables. Okay, if you are aware of C++ or Python then you might be aware of it, but right now just keep in mind that variables are stored at one particular address. So it can be any address. I will just enter like it it what we can say, address is in the form of hexadecimal. So you can write anything, like hexadecimal is like a to f, a 1 to 9, anything you can like this. Okay, so you can think like this is the address and this will be the value. You can suppose like it will be 10 and the name of the variable will be a. Okay, so this is the case happens internally if you create a variable in any operating system. Okay, so now we will start with the basic one, like we will create some variables and we will also learn about some kind of rules which we follow while creating the variables in our shell. Okay, or bash scripting you can say. So here what we will do, I will just create some variables, like I will create name equal to Ayush. Okay, you can write like this. And then what you will need to do, you can also give like age equal to 20, you can say, and now we are good to go. Right now we will just print those variables. So how you can print? Using dollar and the name of the variable, you can easily print the variables. Okay, so just save these variables and I will run this variable. Okay, so here you can see the variable, the first line and the second, my name is printed. Okay, so but before moving forward, let me tell you about some of the rules which we follow while creating the variables. Okay, so there are some interesting thing. If you do like this, add a space, so at that time your shell thinks like it's kind of a command, so there should be no any spaces in your variable name in shell scripting, especially or bash scripting. So if you will do so, it will say command not found. Here you can see, so you don't have to give any kind of a space in your variable name. Okay, I hope it's clear to you guys. Let me just create some another variable like pointer. I will create some kind of 9.9. I will give it 8 times. Okay, it's fine. So here I will add echo, my pointer is like this. Maybe a string concatenation will happen there. Pointer, let me just save and I will again run this script. So here you can see my pointer is this plus. Okay, if I will not give it, it doesn't affect, I think. Okay, so here you can see my pointer is 9.89. So in this way you can enter the variables and enter the values, assign the value to the variables. So these are basically the user defined variables. Okay, echo, you have to just here to user defined variables. Okay, so this is the, okay, so what if I want to print all those in a same line, like echo name and echo is also I want. Okay, let's do it. I will remove this line, save it. Okay, here you can see the Ayush 20. Okay, so these are the user defined variables. Okay, I hope it is clear to you what are the variables. Now moving forward, we will learn about the sum of what we can say environment variables. Okay, so I will just do a quick Google search for you guys and I will search for the user environment variables. Okay, so environment, we will write that much big spelling, environment variables and shell scripting and shell scripting. Yeah, here we got it. Okay, so here you can see there are many blocks for on gigs for gigs or DigitalOcean. Okay, so let me open this one, gigs for gigs. So it's a good website to learn more things. Okay, so here you can see it's loading, just wait for some time. Okay, so here you can see what are the environment variables. So environment variables, system defined variables, you can see it is given by the shell to use for you guys. Okay, so here you can see the scope of an environment variable and all those things. I will tell you about the scope and all those in the next video. Okay, right now just learn about the environment variables. Okay, so here you can see the name is one of the environment variables, both Oracle and Google in the same way. Okay, let me just this. So here you can see, okay, name equal to value. Okay, I will use some different website. Let me use DigitalOcean, not this one. This one looks good. or I will just do list here, because I want the list of the environment variables, and shell script we use. So here you can see the not Windows, I want Linux. Okay, here you can see the echo path, display the path, environment variables. Okay. So let me just use some variables here. Like I remember some variables like echo shell. If you will use shell, and environment variables, keep in mind, like it is written always in the capital letter. And here I will just add some text like first environment variable. Okay, and just save it and run it. And here you will see the bin bash. It gives you the name like shell, which shell you are using right now. Okay, if you will do date also, it will give you the information about date. Okay, so just save it and run it from here. And here you can see the, okay, it's not displaying me the date, why I don't know. Okay, date, it should. Okay, just run this. Okay, I think date is not one environment variable. Let me just quick search for it. Date environment variable Linux. Okay, so here you can see the current environment variables. So there are many articles you can read here, like when you do. We can do like this also. Let me just copy and I will paste it here now, and I will use here now. Okay, just save it and click on run, and here you can see the current date and time, all those things. Okay, so in this way you can use variables, you can assign values, and I hope you got to learn about this user defined variables as well as environment variables. And in the next video also I will tell you some more environment variables. Okay, so I hope you like this particular video, guys, and thank you for watching. And if you have any queries, then you can ask in the comment section. And for these, all the source code I will be posting on my GitHub repository. I will give the link in the description. Okay, so thank you for watching. I'll meet you in the next one. Thank you and bye bye. Now in this video we'll be learning about the how we can get the input from the user. Okay, so basically we will see with the many examples. Like suppose I will ask the user to enter his name, so at that time user should be able to enter his name and all those things. Okay, so basically we will use the read command, or you can read command you can say, or the what you can say, like read keyword is used to take input from the user in the shell scripting. Okay, so actually I have already opened up the terminal here, VS Code, sorry, and I will just create a new file here, 03 read input dot sh. Okay, so I will just use this hash bank bin bash. Okay, I will just give it the name of this tutorial, that is read input. Read input from user. Okay, so first of all we will see the basic scenario. Like suppose I enter here echo enter your name please. Okay, so here I will read the name, and here you will see the this will be the name of the variable. Okay, in which you want to store this value. Okay, and next here I will print the variable, like your name is dollar name. Okay, control s to save, and I want to run from here, but here from here I will need to give permission, but so it's better to run from here. Okay, so here it is asking for me to enter my name, so I will enter Ayush. Okay, why it's not working? Oh my god. Well, let me just control C. Let me use the terminal. Terminal is far better than this. Okay, so we need to just give the permission to that file, that is 03. We are done. ./03.sh. Okay, sorry, ./03.sh, and enter your name please, Ayush. So you can see the your name is Ayush. Okay, so in this way we can take the input from the user, and also there are many use cases of this read command. Okay, so we will learn it one by one. Okay, so let's start with the first one. Like we can use many options like read hyphen p. Okay, so next, moving forward, I will just here I will do a read hyphen p is used for the prompt. So here I will prompt enter your age. Okay, so here you can just give the name of the variable which you want to provide. So you can just give it as age. Okay, and next I will just use this echo command or echo keyword to print the value. Your name, your age is what? $age. Okay, control S to save, clear the screen, again run the script. Your name, my name is Ayush guys, your age, I will enter 20. Here you can see your age is 20. So what is the difference between this and above and this one, rename? So what is happening here, we are using one extra line for echoing that particular line, but using hyphen p option you can write your variable as well as whatever you want to prompt to the user. You can write those all things in one single line. So now let me just comment out these things, and I will again run the command so that will be easy for you to understand. So here it is asking me for enter your age. So here you can see I have just used this single line, and it is asking me to enter the whatever the age and all those things. So don't be confused, it was by mistake 204. I'm not that much old. Okay, so in this way you can use this hyphen p option. Also there is many amazing option, like if I will uncomment this and I will just comment out these things, and if in case you don't provide the variable name, so at that time you can use this reply. Okay, you can use this one to, like, you can use this one like this. Okay, if you don't provide the name of the variable, then it will store it into this reply. So I will just again run up this particular script, and I will write the name as Ayush, and here you can see Ayush, your name is Ayush without any use of variable. Okay, but that is not a very good practice to use, but yeah, it is always advised to use the variables. Okay, so I will give it the name here as name, and the same as it is the dollar name. Okay, dollar name. Okay, we are done, you are good to go. Now there is also some amazing things you should know about. Like suppose I'm asking the user to enter some kind of confidential information, I will just comment out these things, read hyphen p and the username. Okay, suppose you're asking for the username, I will just create a variable username, and you can also ask for password, read hyphen sp, and here you will ask for the password. So obviously you don't want to reveal your password, okay, with everyone. So the hyphen s provides that functionality, you will see right now. So I will just echo those two variables. So here I will write like this, your, not your, just use username and a dollar username. Okay, yeah, we're good to go now, and just use the password. Okay, dollar password. Okay, control S to save. Let me just clear the screen again. This one, username, my username is this one. You can follow me on Instagram. I know I'm promoting. And for password, you can use it's easy to crack. Okay, so here you can see the username is this one and password is this one. But notice, like when I was typing the password, it was not visible. Okay, I will use one more echo for the blank space. Okay, again I will run this script so that could be easy to understand. So I will use username Ayush and the password is something in the C. I am typing, but nothing is displaying on the screen. And here you can see now username is Ayush and password is this, whatever I have written. Don't know what I have written. Okay. So this is the thing. Okay. So I hope you got to learn about like how you can take input from the user. Okay. So now thank you for watching. And if you have any query, you can ask in the comment section and surely I will post these course inside your inside my GitHub repository, not yours. Okay, but you can access that repository. So that's all for today's guide, and I hope you you guys liked it, and we'll meet you in the next video. Thank you for watching. Now in this video we'll be learning about the command substitution. Okay, so as the name suggests, command substitution, which basically means we can use a variable name as a command. Okay, you will store the commands in a variable. It's not that interesting. Okay, so we'll be learning these things in this particular video. So let's start. What first thing you have to do, you have to just open up your you have to just open up the VS Code. Okay, so I have already opened up here the VS Code, as you can see. So now what you have to do, you have to just create one file. I will name it as 04 command substitution dot sh. Okay, I hope his spelling is correct. Yeah, it's correct. By the way, it doesn't matter at all. Okay, so now what we can do, you have to just paste this. Okay, hash bang. Okay, so here let me just enter this like echo. This is no. Not like this. You have to just enter this command substitution tutorial. Okay, tutorial. Okay, so now let me tell you about the first command which we can use as a variable. Okay, so I will create one variable, current directory. Okay, so how you can get the current directory in Linux? Okay, if you have watched our Linux series, then you know the command that is a pwd, present working directory, which gives you the current directory location. Okay, so we will use a pwd, but before using those things right now, I will tell you the ways how you can how we can declare that command to a particular variable. Okay, so you can use the backticks. Okay, just the button left of one. Okay, and here you can enter the whatever command which you want. And right now I want pwd, and you can just print this one like your present working directory is like this, bro. Okay, is, we will use this one, not hash, I need dollar current, not container, current working. Yeah, we are good to go right now. I will just add some permission plus x to that particular file, that is 04. Now we are obviously good to go. Oh, I think something, yeah. So here you can see we have done some silly mistake, like we don't have to give the space here. If we'll give a space, then it will give you the error, command not found. Okay, again, I think command substitution tutorial 04 line 6. Home ISX, so no such file or directory. Wait a minute, you will need to do like this, guys. Okay, so let me just clear the screen. Yeah, we are able to go here. You can see that your present working directory is this one, Home ISX desktop server scripting tutorial. Okay, so in this way, you can use this particular thing, like okay. So now the next method is how you can do it. So the next method is like this. I will just copy it and comment it this line, comment this line, and I will use this like this. You have to use the dollar and the pwd. Okay, so now we can do like this. Clear the screen, hit the command, and here you are good to go, guys. Here you can see the present working directory. Okay, now moving forward, suppose you want to create one file. So new file, I will create the name, a new file, and I will use the backtick. I will use this command cat. I need hello.txt. Suppose in this case I want hello.txt, so I will use this one like here, and I will use echo dollar new file control C, not C, control S to save. Clear the screen. So here you can see hello.txt has been created, and I will write hello.txt has been created from command substitution tutorial. Okay, tutorial, control D to save. Okay, so here you can see the same text. Okay, so in this way you can use the command substitution technique, like using a backtick or using dollar, whatever the way you like. Okay, but the most preferred is this one, dollar and the parenthesis. Okay, so that's all for today's videos, guys. And if you have any query, you can ask in the comment section, and these courses will be posted on the GitHub repository, and you will get the link in the description. So thank you for watching, and I'll meet you in the next one. Thank you, and bye bye. Hello guys, now in this particular video we will be learning about the how we can pass the parameters while running our script. Okay, so let's start with this video. Okay, so I have already opened up my VS Code, and you can also open it using the terminal or from here, from applications also. So right now we'll create a new file, that is arguments.sh. okay, I will write the hashbang or shebang, you can say whatever you want. Bin bash. Okay, now here what we will do, I will run this script and I will pass some arguments and parameters, and we will use those parameters and do some manipulation in those things. Okay, so before the starting the video, let me tell you first thing, like suppose I run the script, this one, command substitution, or maybe see which script I have run. Oh yeah, suppose this command substitution is one of the script. So here I will pass some parameters, like I will pass my name, my number, okay, and my something like country India. So in these way we can pass the parameters. Okay, and how we will access these parameters? So you can access these parameters using like this, like using echo dollar one. Okay, dollar one for the first parameter, echo dollar two for the second parameter, echo dollar three for the third parameter. So here you can access till dollar nine, and dollar zero is reserved, and it gives you the name of your script. Okay, so this is the in this way you can work with the parameters. And now what we have to do, we will just save this file, and what we will do, we will just run this particular script. I will just give the permissions to this chmod plus x and 05 arguments.sh, and I will clear the screen, and I will just run those script 05. Okay, done. And now what I will do, I will just pass some parameters. Like right now I want to pass my name Ayush. Okay, I will pass my country India. I will pass my number. Okay, and then I will pass something shell tutorial. I can write like this. Okay, so when I will hit enter, then you will see what happens. So here you can see first line giving me the name of the script, second line the second first parameter, then third is the second parameter, then my number, and we are not getting the cell tutorial. Why? Because we have not used $4. Okay, so we will use here echo $4, and again I will run the same script. Okay, now here you can see all the what we can say arguments we have got in these form. Okay, so you have to also remember one thing here, like if I am going to just pass the one parameter, in this case the other will be ignored. Okay, so as you can see others have been ignored, that is nothing. Okay, and if you want to give the like this, suppose I want to I want my full name like Ayush Kumar. So if I will do this, so now it will act like this will be act as a first parameter, this will be act as second parameter. So to act like to use this as a one parameter, you can use this. Okay, so now you will get this. Okay, output. Okay, so I hope you got it how you can work with the parameters. And now moving forward, if you want to get the list of all the parameters you pass, so there are the some special characters, or yeah, you can say characters. So how will you use to print all the arguments? We will use $@, and now it will print all the arguments which you will pass. So what I will do, I will run this script, this one, and here you can see I have got the all the arguments which we have passed, like Ayush, India, number and cell tutorial. Okay, and also there is one more, like echo $hash to get how many number of parameters we have passed, not this one, $hash. Okay, so again just clear the screen and I will run this script, and here we can see we have passed the four parameters. Yeah, that's true. Okay, now what we can do, we can also store the value of these parameters which we pass in a variable. Suppose I want to store like name equal to $1, and I will just remove this, not I will do, I will just keep it up. Okay, and then I will try to access my name. So here I can give my name is like this. We can do also $name. Okay, save these, and now I will just clear the screen and I will run this, and here you can see my name which I use. So you can store the whatever the arguments you have passed in a variable also. So in this way you can pass the parameter, pass the value. Okay, so I hope you liked it guys, and I hope you understood it. If you have any query, you can ask in the comment section. And also here you can see I have updated this repository, and I will give the link of this particular repository. You can access this like from here, like github.com/io098hub, and this one, cell scripting tutorial. Okay, from here you can get the whatever we are writing the course, like you will get each and every source code there. Okay, so that's all for today's guide. I hope you liked it, and I will meet you in the next video. So thank you guys for watching. Bye bye. Hello guys, now in this particular video we will be creating our the first task, that is the basically in which we will whatever we have covered till now, we will use those things. So basically let me tell you the scenario what we will be doing in this particular video. So basically we will first read the input from the user. Okay, that will be the IP or domain name. And next what we will do, we will be using the ping command to ping that particular server. Okay, so things are very easy. If you want to go ahead with yourself, then you can go for it. So it will give you the more confidence about it. Okay, so now I will use this scenario and I will create one script. So actually already I have opened my Visual Studio Code, and you have to just create one script, and I will use the hashbang. Sorry. Okay, so now what we have to do, we have to take input from the user. So already we have covered how we can take input. So you can use the read here, and you will prompt for the user like which server you want to ping. Okay, it can be any server, it all depends upon you. And I will create one variable here, server address. And next, moving forward, what I will use the ping command. So basically in ping command we have some options like hyphen c. So whatever, if you use normal ping command, so like if I will use google.com, so here you can see it will go in the infinite loop, but if we want only for the 3 or 4, okay, so what we can do, we can give the count for 3 and the deadline for 5 seconds. After 5 seconds, if nothing, like ping command doesn't get any response, then it will exit. So next, what we will do, we have to just give this name, server address. Now we are good to go. What we have to do, you have to just add the permission to this file using chmod command, and then I will run this, not 01, I have to write 06. Okay, so I want to ping Google server, that is 8.8.8. Okay, so here you can see I'm getting the response. Okay, and now what I will do, I will enter some random IP like 8.6.52.4. So it will wait for the five seconds and automatically it will exit. So here you can see. Okay, so yeah, here we can see 5 packet transmitter but 0 received, 100% packet loss. Okay, so in this way you can create different scripts, so that will be helpful for you. So that's all for today's video. I hope you like this, our first talks. So that's all guys, and I hope you liked it, and we will meet in the next video. Thank you for watching. Hello guys, now in this video we will be talking about our task 2. Okay, so let me discuss with you what we will be doing in our this task. So basically we will be connecting our remote machine with SSH using bash script. Okay, we will create a script with the help of this, we will connect to that particular machine. So we first of all, let me tell you how you can create your virtual machine. So actually I have, there is a link for you, I will add this link in our description. Then there is a tutorial to create a virtual machine, you can easily do it. Okay, and I have actually already created the machine. So here is my public IP address, I will copy this IP address, and now I will create the script. Okay, so let me open the VS Code and I will just create the file 07task2.sh. okay, but before that I will tell you, like if you want to do it on yourself, you can easily do it. Okay, so if you do it yourself, then that will be very good for you. So because you will get a more confidence as well, you will learn more quickly. So let me, I will just give you the basic idea of what we will be doing. So I will take the username and the password, okay, not username and the IP, and then I will use the SSH command to connect with that machine. So this is the overall idea. And if you want to take input from the parameter, then also you can do it. Okay, so first of all, let's take the input. I will prompt the user to enter the username first, username, and then here I will create the username variable. Then I read hyphen p, enter the IP. So here I create the IP variable. I will use SSH command, SSH dollar username, we need to do dollar username at the rate dollar IP. Okay, so this is the command which we will use. Okay, otherwise we can do with the passing parameters also, we will do it that also. So now I will need to give the permission to this file 07. Now we will execute this file 07, and I will enter the username as Ayush, and my IP is not this one here. Okay, and my IP is this, and it will ask me to enter the password, so I will enter the password. Okay, so here you can see I use the name of the VM is also Ayush, that's why it's showing like this. I will do ls here, so nothing is there. Who am I? So name of the user is Ayush here also. So in this way you can connect with the remote machine using our bash script. Okay, so you can do exit to exit, come out of the machine. And now we will see how we can connect with the using like parameters. Okay, so what I will do, I will just comment out these all, and I will create a variable username, and it will be equal to the dollar one, okay, the first parameter. Then the IP will be equal to the dollar two. Okay, we will save this script and I will just pass the parameters like Ayush for username and IP for this. Okay, 247. Hit enter and it will ask me to enter the password. Now we are good to go. And again, let's check, who am I? Ayush. Okay, so in this way you can connect with the remote machine easily. You can use environment variables, not environment variables, you can pass parameters, you can use variables, okay, whatever thing you want to do. So I hope you liked it. So this is a way to learn new things by while doing some new things like create. I will, like, in future I will come up with the more task. Okay, so that's all for today's guide, and I hope you have used all the concepts which you have learned till now. So that's all, and I meet you in the next video. Thank you for watching. Hello guys, now in this particular video we will be learning about the operators. Okay, so let me first discuss with you what we'll be covering in this particular video. So we will go first with the arithmetic operators, then we will go with the relational and the boolean and so on. Okay, so I hope you guys have completed our previous video. So now let's just create the new script, that is 08operators.sh. okay, just add the hash bang or bin shebang, you can say. Okay, now I will create one variable n1, enter n1, and I will create the variable name as n1, read hyphen p, enter n2, give the variable name as n2, then I will echo, I will do addition is, or just addition. So to, for in cell, how you do it, we cannot write like this n1 plus n2. There is a proper syntax for it. You need to write like this n1 plus n2. Okay, or you can, inside also you can give dollar, but there is no need. Okay, so now in this way you can write the expression inside these two parentheses and the dollar sign outside of that expression. Okay, so let me just run this script once. I will give first the certain permission to this file, and then I will execute it. D08 and n1 is 4, that is 8. Yeah, we are good to go. Now I will just copy all these things like addition. So here you can go with the subtraction. What I'm doing, wait, subtraction, then here you can go for multiplication, and here division. Okay, and next we can go with modulus also. So let's go with modulus. Okay, modulus. Okay, modulus. Now let's give the operator, like here it will be percent, let me just write like this so that it will be easy to read for you. For division you have to give this forward slash, for multiplication you know the star, and for the subtraction there is the minus. Okay, so let's run this script and we will get the output for each and every number. So I will give the 10 and 5. So as you can see, the addition is 15, subtraction is 5, multiplication is 50, division is 2, and modulus is 0. Why? Because modulus gives you the remainder. Okay, if you do 3 by 2, then in that case you will get the remainder as 1. So as you can see, the modulus is 1. Okay, now next you can do increment operator and decrement operator also you can use. So how you can do it, using plus plus and minus minus. Okay, so I will do echo increment So here we will use dollar, and what you have to increment n1 plus plus, or what you can do plus plus n1. It will first increase and then print the value. Okay, so let's just run the script. Clear, enter the n1 5 5. So as you can see, incremented 6. Okay, in case if you do n1 plus plus, so here we will not see the increment because it first prints the value then increments. Okay, so in this case we will get the value as 5 here. Okay, so but now what we will do, if we will echo the n1, then we will get the 6. Okay, so let me just clear the screen. Enter 5 5. Okay, so now here you can see you have got the 6. So I hope you got the concept of increment and decrement. If plus plus is after the variable name, then it will first print, then it will increment. If plus plus is first, then it will increment, then print. Okay, so similar case with decrement. Echo decrement, where is the dollar, and you have to do minus minus n2. Use, yeah, n2 we can use, and here also I do leave it as it is. So clear the screen, enter n1 5, n2 6, and now decrement value with 6. First it was 7 and now it is 6. Okay, so I hope you got it, how the things are working. Okay, so now let's check with some relational operators like equal to, greater than, equal to, less than, equal to, greater than, less than, all those things. Okay, now you have to just echo. Here I'm writing just automatic operators. Okay, just copy it and you have to go there and just write here relational operators. Okay, I just comment out these things. Okay, so now what we have to do, so now we will use this relational operator with the if else. So till now we have not covered the if else, but still we can use it. Okay, so how will you do it? We will use if, and then the big bracket, this is the whatever the condition we will write in this. So $n1, and we use gt for greater than and $n2. Okay, and then, so don't worry, I will teach you about if else in our next video. Okay, so you have to just echo n1 greater than n2 like this, and then you have to close the if block. Okay, so gt means greater than, and there are also many like gt for greater than and ge for greater than equal to, and lt for less than, le for greater than equal, less than equal to, ne for not equal to. Okay, like this you can use. Okay, so we will use first gt and then we will use other options in next. Okay, so now you can run the script 08 and I will write 5 and 4. So here you can see, yeah, n1 is greater than n2. Now I will change the g to ge and I will write here greater than equal to. So now let me just clear the screen and run the script again. So 5 and 5, so yeah, n1 greater than equal to it, this line is executing. And you can do now lt if n1 less than equal to. So n1 less here I will do, and I will again run the script. So 5 4 5, so yeah, n1 less than n2, it is executing again, less than equal to. So we can use like this, 4 4, yeah, it is executing. We can use hyphen eq to check equality, hyphen eq we can do like this, 5 5, yeah, here we have not changed, but still you can think like. Okay, so now what we do, 5 and 5, and here you can see n1 equal to n2. So in this way we can use the relational operators. Now let me tell you about the AND operator. So AND operator is nothing but if both the condition becomes true, then whatever inside that condition will be executed. Okay, so if n1 equal to n2 and I use a hyphen a option to check and operator, and I will check if dollar n1 is greater than 1. Okay, if this is the case, then this line will be executed. Okay, so n1 I will write 5 5, and n1 greater than 1, yes. So okay, I am getting some error here. Okay, you can write like this, clear, 5 5, yeah. Now here you got the like output as n1 equal to n2. Now what I will do, I write 0 0, and let's check what happens, whether we will get any output or not. So here we are not getting any output, but now we can use hyphen o option for OR operator. Okay, so let me just clear this screen and use like this hyphen 0 0. So in this case, this condition is equal, like this condition satisfies n1 equal to n2. That's why this particular line has been executed. Okay, so in this way operator and OR operator works. So that's all for this video, guys. I hope you liked it, and yeah, if you have any query, then you can ask us in the comment section, and I will surely update this code in our GitHub repository. I will add the link in our description. So that's all for today. I will meet you in the next video. Thank you for watching. Hello guys, now in this particular video we're learning about the if else conditions. Okay, so let's start with the video, and I hope you are aware of if else, but if not, then let me tell you first what is this. So basically, if else, what happens if there will be one condition, if that condition satisfies it is true, then the whatever the statement you write inside that if block, that will execute. Okay, so without wasting time, first of all, let me tell you about how will we write this script, so that will be easy to understand for you. So 09, I will write here if else dot sh. Okay, we are good to go now. Okay, bin bash. Okay, so here, just suppose this scenario, a equal to 10. Okay, if I will write if, and the condition is written inside this big bracket. Okay, and here you have to do if a equal to 10. Okay, so then you have to write like this, then what do you want? If this condition satisfy, you have to write like this. You can do anything. Here I am doing just printing like a is equal to 10. Okay, and you can do like in else, you can write like this, echo a is not equal to 10. Okay, and then to close the if block, you can write like this, fi. So I will run this script, but before that, we will need to add the permissions. 09 it is, yeah, clear the screen, ./09 9. Okay, 09, yeah, a is equal to 10. What if I do 11 here and run this script? So in this case, this condition will not satisfy. Okay, so how we can do it? 09, a is not equal to 10. So I hope you got it, how this thing work, like if conditions. So we will take the scenario of voting system, like there will be person age. We will take the input from the user. I will just comment out these things. Okay, read, and I will do here age. Okay, or I will prompt for the user, enter your age. Here I will do age. Okay, and we will apply the conditions on this. If age, where is the dollar? If age is greater than equal to 18, in this case we will write echo you are eligible to cast vote. Okay, in else condition, what we can write? Echo you are not eligible to cast vote. Okay, and we have to just close this if block. Control S to save, clear the screen. Enter your age, 23, you are eligible to cast vote. Again, 12, you are not eligible to cast vote. Okay, if or I can just do a greater than, okay, and I use one more thing, that is elif. It's also like the if, but if this condition fails, it will check for this particular condition. Here I will write if age equal to, just equal to, I will use equal to 18. So in this case I want echo please apply for voter ID card. Okay, and here we will not use 10. So now what we can do, clear the screen, run the script. I will write my age equal to 18. So what happened? Okay, I think we will write 10. Okay, yeah, please apply for voter ID card. Okay, so this is the elif condition, that's why we will need to write the then. Okay, so right now what's happening, whatever the age we are entering, so here it is first checking this condition. If this condition fails, it will come upon this condition. So now this condition executes, that's why it is giving the output as this line. Okay, what if the output doesn't match with any condition? In this case, what will happen? The else condition will execute. You are not eligible to cast vote. Simple. Okay, so in this way you can use if, elif, else conditions in your projects. Okay, so that's all for today's videos, guys. I hope you liked it. You will get the source code of this particular video in our GitHub repository. You can get it from there also. Okay, so that's all for today's, guys. I will meet you in the next video, and thank you for watching. Hello guys, now in this video we'll be learning about the case statement. Okay, so if you are aware of the switch statements in different languages, then you it will be very easy for you guys, but not let me tell you about how it will work. So why this basically came in role, first of all we will discuss about this. So in many programs you get to know about that there are multiple if else conditions, and that will be very confusing. But in case of switch case, or you can use you can tell the case statement, it is very easy to understand those things and use it. So what I will do, I will just create a new file, that is a case.sh. okay, so I will take the example of the grading system. Okay, so if the grade is A, then that will be very good. Like we will print something out, enter grade, I will write like this, and I will create a variable grade. And how will we use it? We will use it case dollar grade. Okay, and then what we'll do, we'll use the in keyword, and here we will add the certain conditions, like if the grade is A, then what to do. So here I will do like A, then what we have to do, not this one, wait a minute, yeah, I have to use only this bracket, closing bracket. So in this case I will echo, it's your marks is between 90 to 100. Okay, I can use like this. Then if the grade is B, no, and but before that what we have to do, you have to just add this semicolon. Like this is the syntax of using the switch case in this. So for B you will write like echo your marks is in between 81 to 90, like this. Okay, and so on. Like let me call use the semicolon, and then we will use here C grade, and then I will echo your marks is in between 71 to 80. Okay, and then we have to just use the asterisk we can use for default, and here we will use the semicolon first, and here I will echo your marks is below 70, like this. And then we have to use the ESAC keyword, and we are good to go. Now we will just give the permission to this script 10. Okay, done. Now I will run this script 10. You enter my grade, I will enter C. Your marks is between this. Okay, I will enter B. Your marks is between this. I will enter E. So your marks is below 70. Okay, so in this way this thing works. Okay, so I hope you like this video, guys, and if you have any confusion about this, you can ask us in the comment section. Okay, and I will surely add this course in our GitHub repository. You can access this course from there. Okay, so that's all for today's, guys. I will meet you in the next video. So thank you for watching. Hello guys, now in this particular video we'll be learning about the array in cell script. Okay, so you can see already I have created this file, that is arrays.sh, and added this shebang. So before starting the video, let me first describe you what is an array. So I will just write it like this. So array, you can say like that, is array is nothing but a data structure which is used for storing multiple values in a single variable, you can say. Okay, so this is the array, simple. Suppose let me tell you the one use case. Like suppose you have to store multiple names. Okay, suppose you have to store 10 names. So how will you create it? Like if you don't know about array, you will just do like this: name 1 equal to Ayush, name 2 equal to some another name like Ankit, name 3 equal to, let's create some, write some name like Ayushi, name 4 equal to Avinash, like this. Okay, so this is not a good practice of storing names in different variables. So that's why array came in role, for storing multiple values in a single variable. Okay, so I will first tell you about the like array initialization. What is the method of array initialization, like how you can create arrays in cell scripting. So it's a very simple. So you have to just give an array name. Suppose name list, I will give name list equal to this single parenthesis, and here you have to store multiple names like Ayush, like here I will write Ankit, Ayushi and Avinash. Okay, so here you can see all the names has been stored in a single variable, that is the name list. Okay, so now you will think about how you will access these arrays. Okay, that's the point, like how you will access it. So let me tell you first about array indexing. Okay, it is used to access the elements present in an array. Okay, so array indexing is basically used to access the elements in an array. So it starts from zero. Suppose this is the array, so the first element will have index 0, second one will have 1, this one will have 2, and this one will have 3. Okay, so here is 4 elements. So like there is like index starts from 0 and ends with n minus 1, that is 3, that is 4 minus 1, that is equal to 3. So to accessing the elements of an array, we will use these index. Okay, like if I will enter the index 0, so at index 0 Ayush is present, at index 1 this Ankit is present, index 2 is Ayushi, index 3 is Avinash. Okay, so now let me tell you first about how you can access the arrays. Okay, so I will just use the echo, so we will simply print the whatever the index present. Okay, so how you can do it: echo dollar and this curly braces, and you have to provide the array name, that is name list, and the big bracket and the index which you want. So I want 0 index. Okay, so I will just wait a minute, I will just comment out these things. Yes,
and I will run this script. Okay, so 11.sh. So let's run 11.sh. What happened? Ls. Okay, I will need to give the particular permission. Yeah, ./11. Yeah, so here you can see, so this one is printing like add is nothing but a data structure. So I will also comment out these thing, and it will just print up the first index. Okay, wait a minute, I write like this: echo first index. Let me run this. So here you can see the first index is this. Similarly, I will print all the other three indexes. So I will just copy these things, and here I will just write the second, and here we will write the third, and here fourth, and you have to just change the number here, like index number, that 0 1, that is 2, and that is 3. Just control save, clear, ./11.sh, and yeah, so here you can see the first index, second index, third index, fourth index. So here the main thing is that it's like you can access or you can store multiple values in a single variable, you can see here. So but in this case you had to create multiple variables to store those values, so that's not a good practice. So instead of this, you can use an array. So one more thing is, like, if you want to print the multiple arrays, all the elements of an array, so how you will do it? There is also the special syntax for this, like we use asterisk, okay, for printing. So you can use like this: echo all arrays, all array elements. So I will just write like this: name list, and this one, and here you can see the asterisk. You have to just clear the screen, and this one, all array elements is here: Ayush, Ankit, Ayushi. And one more syntax is there, like you can use @ also for accessing all the elements. So here you can see. Okay, so that's it guys for today's video. I hope you liked it, and yeah, one more thing, I will upload this code in my GitHub directory or your repository, you can say. Here you will see. Okay, you can get this from shell scripting tutorial. I will add it here. Okay, so that's it for today guys, and I will meet you in the next video, and in the next video we'll be learning about the for loops and all those things. Okay, so that's all for today's video guys. Thank you. Hello guys, now in this particular video we'll be working on the loops. Okay, so basically today we will start with the for loop, and actually there are different types of loops, but before that let me first create the file, that is the forloop.sh. So forloop.sh. okay, so now we are done. Let me just add this shebang. Okay, so let me just first discuss about you the what is the loop. Suppose if you want to do some task, that is the there that like exists, there is some kind of repetition of thing. Suppose like if you have watched the meme, like boyfriend send her girlfriend like I love you 100 times 100 times. So what is this thing? This is basically a loop. Okay, so loop is nothing but you can say, like, in kind of definition, like what you can say, iterations. Okay, like doing one thing again and again and again. Okay, so suppose let me first tell me with an example. Suppose in some cases, like suppose if you got some punishment and you have to write sorry for a teacher, and your teacher says like you have to write the sorry 100 times and all those things, or 5 times. So similarly what you will do, you will do like this, like echo sorry. If you don't know the loop and all those things, you will write just like this: sorry, 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 and like you will just simply copy and paste things. Okay, so this is what is this. This is the repetition of the same thing. So this repetition is managed by or removed by the loops. Okay, so basically there are the three types of loop, that is the for loop, while loop, until loop. Okay, I will be discussing all these two loops in our further videos, but now in this video we'll be working only on the for loop. Okay, so let's start with the first thing. But before that, I will create one array. Okay, and I will be working on that first. Okay, so let me create an array, and in this I will use the loop. Okay, so I will just create with some languages name like Python, C++, Java, and C, and yeah, like comma is not required. Okay, so but before that, let me just print the these arrays, so I can like check everything is working fine or not. Okay, my array, and I will just provide asterisk here, and I will just give the certain permission for this file, that is the 12 chmod plus x12, okay, dot slash 12. Okay, so here you can see the power, this array is working fine. Okay, and so now what I will do, I have to just print this array using the for loop. Okay, how you can do it, but before that, let me tell you first about the syntaxes and all those things of for loop. So the basic syntax for loop is like this: for parenthesis, here the initialization will be there, initialization, here will be the condition. If you know about the C programming or Java programming, then that, or CPP, so it's very easy for you to understand this. Okay, but if you don't know, then also you can get it right now. Okay, and here will be the increment or decrement. Okay, and the two curly braces like this. Okay, so what is this? This is the syntax for loop. Okay, so let me tell you how the thing works. Okay, so suppose I want to print like this number of times, 5 times. So I will start with the 0 or 1, it's all upon you, and I will provide the condition like that. I will create one variable at I equal to 0, and I will provide the condition, that is I less than 5 and I plus plus. Okay, so let me just open up my paint so I can like you should visualize that thing. Okay, so where is text? Yeah, so here simply I write one for loop, that is I equal to 0, I should less than 6 or 5 if you're starting for this one from 0. Okay, so this is the for loop. Okay, and I will just echo here the sorry statement. Okay, so here now what you have to think is like how the things are working. Okay, so let me just do like this. Okay, so how things are working basically, so when your loop will run, so how it runs, so it will first assign I value 0. If I equal to 0, okay, it will check the condition. So I will just define the titles for them. Here I will do initialization, here will be the condition, and here will be the increment. Okay, so why increment? Because here I am using the I++, it simply means it will increment the value of I by 1. Okay, so now here what I will do, so you can see the one, like right now there is I equal to 0. Okay, so it will now first check the condition whether I is less than 5, this one. So yeah, 0 is less than 5. So if condition is true, it will print the sorry. So here in this case, 0 less than 5, condition is true. Okay, and it will, what it will do, it will print. Okay, so here I will do like print what it is printing. So it is printing sorry, and then again it will increment the value of I to I plus plus, that is now the value of I will become 1. Okay, so here again I will give like here this I equal to 1, so again it will check whether 1 less than 5. Yeah, 1 less than 5, true, it will print sorry. Okay, and again it will increment the value to 2. Okay, now again loop will run for 2, like I will be 2, and it will check whether 2 less than 5. Yeah, 2 less than 5, condition is true, and it will print sorry again, and the I will become increased by 1 from here, like I will be 3. Okay, so similarly again I will be 3 here and it will check like 3 less than 5. Yeah, condition is true. So what it will do, like it will print sorry. Okay, and again the value of I will get increased by 1, that is 4. And again now it will do I will be 4 and it will check, let me just increase this size here, I equal to 4. Okay, and it will do whether 4 less than 5. Yeah, it's less than 5, condition is true, and it will print sorry first and then it will increment the value of I to 5. Okay, and now I will become 5 and it will check whether 5 less than 5. So here condition is false and what will happen, loop will end. Okay, and it will print sorry 5 times. Okay, if you're starting your loop from 0. Okay, so this is the simple working of the for loop, like how things are working. So now let me just tell you about with the experiment part how you can get it. Okay, so let me just open up this one and I will just comment out these things. Okay, and for loop, and I will initialize the value of I from 0 to I less than 5 because I have to print 5 times. I plus plus echo sorry. Okay, just control S to save. Again, let me run the script. Which number it is? 12. Okay, it's not this one, sorry, 12. Yeah, so here you can see 5 times sorry has been printed. Okay, but what if you want like if you do less than equal to 5? So in this case, suppose less than equal to 5, so it will print to you, it will print 6 times. So here you can see 6 times has been printed. Why this happened? Because at this point, now if there is less than equal to, so here the condition is satisfied, like yeah, 4, 5 is less than equal to 5, so condition is satisfying and it will be true and sorry will get printed, and then sorry will be printed, and then I will be equal to 6. And now if you will check, it will check the condition, that is 6 less than 5, so that condition is false. So in this case our loop will get end and you will come out of the loop. Okay, so in this way for loop works. I hope you got it. And let me just tell you one more thing, like how things work, and like there is also some different syntax of for loop. Okay, so the different syntax is this, like this, for var, suppose you have to provide some list, like you can do like this, for I in, and you will provide a list like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. You can do like this also, okay? Or you can provide some any other variables also, like you can provide string names also and all those things. And here you will just do, okay? And in this, what you will do, I will just print like this, echo iteration colon, and here I will just write the I. Okay, and then you will write here done. Okay, control S to save. I will just comment out this loop, and again I will just run this script. Okay, so here you can see the iteration I is printed, not the value. Okay, so at that point I will just provide the dollar. Okay, yeah, so here you can see iteration 1, let me just clear this screen and again run this script. So here you can see 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10. Okay, so in this way also you can run loop. Suppose if you want to do some operation of if one comes, or like suppose I provide here some different list, like the name list, suppose Ayush. Okay, so here suppose if you want to do like this, if and the condition which you will give, like dollar I equal to Ayush. So in this case, what you should do, like then echo, what should we echo, like you can echo like, yeah, like this, Ayush is a good boy. Okay, and you have to just write what you can say, close the if condition. I will save it and I will just run this. So here it is showing some kind of error, like unexpected token then at line number 29. Wait a minute, I have whether let me write like this first, and I will do it in the colon, not colon. Okay, why it's showing error I'm not getting. Let me just if dollar I equal to Ayush, then echo fee. Yeah, it's correct. Wait a minute. Okay, so basically I got it. So here you have to just provide one space. So I was doing just some silly mistakes. So let me again run this script, clear dot slash slash, yeah. So here you can see, sorry, which script I ran? I have to run 12, sorry. 12, okay. So here you can see Ayush is a good boy. So if dollar I equal to Ayush, then it is printing like, yeah, Ayush is a good boy. Okay, so I can do write like this, like dollar I. Okay, so it will also run. So Ayush is a good boy. Okay, in this case you can see. So basically you can you can just initialize or write your for loop in this syntax also. Okay, so if you are familiar with the C programming or CPP, then that is very easy for you, and if you are for same like familiar with Python, then this one is also fine for you. Okay, so now let me tell you first about how you can print the array elements. Okay, so in our previous classes we have learned about array. So here you can see I've created array here. Let me just create it below. I will comment out this, and I will just create array, and I will just add some other languages also, like Kotlin I will add, and some other frameworks like React, JavaScript, shell scripting. Okay, so this is my array. Okay, so now I have to print this array, okay, using for loop. So how will you will print an array using for loop? So basically we will need to define the condition, like array should be less than the size minus 1. So here what is the size of the array? That is 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8. So 0 to 7 we have to do. So in this case you will use the normal loop that we use in other programming language, that I equal to 0, I should be less than 7, and I plus plus, and we will just echo the indexes. Okay, so how you will do it, my array name, and I will provide the index as I, and we are good to go. Now let me just run this script. Yeah, here you can see all the array elements have been printed in the same order. Okay, so that's it for today guys. I hope you liked it, like how the for loop works, and you like this representation also, like everything should be clear for you. If you have any problem, then please ask to me. Okay, so that's all for this guys, and I will add this code in our GitHub repository. You can access from there and provide the link in the description. So thank you guys for watching this video, and I will meet you in the next video. Thank you. Hello guys, now in this particular video I'll be talking about the while loop. Okay, so basically I have covered already the for loop, and in which we have discussed about the basics of looping and how loops work. Okay, so now let's start with the while loop. Let me create this file first, loop.sh, and I will just add this shebang or hashbang you can say here. Okay, so Here we go. So now while loop is also just like the for loop, but it is it works until the condition is true. Okay, if condition gets false, we can come out from the loop, and if condition is true, it will execute that particular thing. Okay, so let me just give you the syntax part, like what is the syntax of while loop. So while space and this double space, and here you have to write the condition. Okay, and then you will write like this, do, and whatever the code you want to perform here, and then you have to do like here, you have to write here done. Okay, so this is the basic syntax of the while loop. Okay, so now we will see the visualization part. So let me open up my paint first. Okay, but before that, let me just copy this one code where it is here. Okay, now I have copied. Let me just paste it here. Okay, I will need to just create this one like this to add the text and all those things. So here we go, and let me just remove this part. Okay, and also we forgot about this one, like we need to give the semicolon and all those things. Okay, so let's start with the implementation one. Suppose same case, if you want to print something like my name, if I want to print my name 5 times, say how the thing will work. Okay, so basically, so here we will need to give the condition, like we can give the I, like I should be less than equal to 4 or less than 5. You can give the condition, and above you can declare the I variable. Okay, and here you will write the code like echo and my name Ayush. Okay, so how the thing will work, let me tell you. Here we will give the value of I, and then we will check the condition and then increment. Okay, so initially the value of I is 0, and condition will be get checked like 0 is less than equal to 4. Yes, it is less than equal to 4. So now what it will do, it will print. So here I write the print. So here what it will print, it will print simple Ayush. Okay, and the value we get incremented by 1. So now value of I will be 1, and it will again check the condition whether 1 less than equal to 4. Yes, it is true. So again print the name Ayush, and again increase the variable to like 2. It will, so now I will be 2, and again I will check the variable name like 2 less than equal to 4. Okay, and print, and again it will increase the value of I by 1, so I will be 3, and again it will check whether 3 less than equal to 4. Yes, it is true, and again it will print, and again value of I will get increased by 1, that is 4. Now I will be 4, and it will check, yes, 4 less than equal to 4. Yes, it is not less than, but yeah, it is equal to 4. So in this case also, I will get print, and value of I will be 5. Now it will check I equal to 5, whether 5 less than equal to 4. No, it's not. So this is the false condition, and we can come out from the loop. Okay, so same thing we have to do in while loop also. So how we can do it, let's me just go into the terminal, and I will just comment out this part. Okay, so here what I will do, I will define the variable I equal to 0, and I will give the condition like while, and condition will be I should be less than equal to 4, and do what, do nothing, just echo echo my name, that is the Ayush. Okay, and here you can do done, and also to increment, you can increment like this, let I plus plus. Okay, here we forgot to increment this one, so here we will increase the value of I. Okay, so the same thing we have to do, and now let's check whether this works or not. So I will just give the appropriate permission, 12_while_loop clear /12_while_loop. So here you can see no such file or directory, why it's showing like this. Okay, let me just copy this code, and I will delete this file. Actually, 12 is 2 times, so I will create like 13 while loop dot sh and paste it, control s, give the appropriate permission, 13, clear dot slash 13, and here we go. And again, what is showing? Line number, oh sorry, here we have to give the this one hyphen eq less than equal to le. Okay, now it should run. Okay, so here you can see 5 times Ayush has been printed. Okay, so in this form you can create the while loop. Okay, so again, if you want to use the while loop with an array, we can use it also, like to print the array. So I will just create the array, array equal to, I'll write 1 2 3 4 5, so size of array is 5, and less than equal to 5, okay, or less than equal to 4, it doesn't matter here. And I will just echo the array indexes. Okay, and let me just again run the script, and here you can see we have successfully accessed all the elements of an array. So in this case, in this way you can use the while loop. So I hope you got it, and I will add this particular file in our GitHub repository. So that's all for today's guide, and I will meet you in the next video. Thank you for watching. Now in this video I will be talking about the until loop. Okay, so already we have covered the for loop, here you can see, and the while loop. Okay, so now let's start with the until loop. Okay, so before starting, let me first tell you about this, what is this, how this loop actually works. So until loop is basically, it works until the condition is false. Okay, so it's quite interesting, like it works when until the condition is false. Whenever your condition becomes true, you will come out of the loop, just like the reverse of the while loop. Okay, so it's just like you, if you will say like 2 is greater than 5, so yeah, then in that condition the loop will run. If you will say like 6 is greater than 5, now in that condition this loop will not work, like you will come out of the loop. Okay, so I will do a visualization for you, and I will open up my paint to show you. But before that, let me just write the syntax here. Sorry, what happened here? Wait a minute, guys. I will open the paint in different window. Yeah, and I will open up my terminal. Okay, so now let me just create the syntax for you. So the syntax is very easy, just like the while loop. So you have to just give the until and the whatever the condition you will provide here, condition and the do, and then here you will write the code and done. Okay, this is the basic syntax, and the increment decrement, whatever you want to do here, you can do like this. Okay, I++ or whatever. Okay, so here you can see, I will just copy up this syntax and I will open up my paint, so that will be easy for you to understand. So I will take the same example of printing the name and all those things, because that will be easy for you to understand. Okay, so here I want to print my the same thing like my name. So I will provide the variable I equal to 0, and I should be less than equal to 3, I will choose right now. So it will print I think 4 times, and then I will increase the increment, let i++, and here I will write the code. The code will be like Ayush. I will just write like this, and here what you have to do, you have to give the wrong information, like false condition you have to provide. So here I will do like I greater than equal to 3. So here if condition is false, then it will execute this code. Okay, so value of I, so I'm writing like this, V of I, and then the condition check. Okay, and then increment. Okay, or I can write like this, print also. Okay, so currently value of I is I equal to 0, so 0 greater than equal to 3, Yes, condition is false. Okay, so if false, then it will execute. So it is right now 0 greater than equal to 3. That is key. What false? Okay, so in this case, what it will do? It will print Ayush, and the value of I will get increased by 1. So I will be 1 right now. So here again, it will check 1 is greater than equal to 3. Condition is false. So again, it will what it will do? It will print. Okay, so it will print now condition will increase by 1, that is now I will become 2, so I equal to 2. So here again 2 is greater than equal to 3, so again this condition is false, so Ayush will get printed. Okay, so now I increment by 1, that is I will become 3, so now for I equal to 3, so 3 greater than equal to 3. Yes, condition is false, it will be false. Okay, and Ayush will get printed and increment by 4. Now I equal to 4, so 4 is greater than equal to 3. Yeah, condition is now true, so now you will come out of the loop. Okay, so in this way until loop, it basically just the opposite of while loop. Like if condition is false, the loop will execute, otherwise not. So let me just do with this run this loop. I will provide the I equal to 0 and I will use until loop until condition will be dollar of I is only greater than, if I use a greater than equal to 3. So in this case, do echo Ayush. Okay, and just do it done here. And you have to just increment the value of I also. Okay, now we are good to go. I will just give the appropriate permission to this file 14. Okay, ./14, and we got some kind of error here. Line number 21, syntax error. Okay, here I do semicolon. Let me just check now. Unexpected end of line. Let me just check the syntax, like I equal to 0 until dollar of I is greater than equal to 3, do echo Ayush, and then let I plus plus, and I have written done here, right? Do and done. Okay, so here you can see we have not comment out this. So let me just comment it, and again I will run this script. Let me just clear the screen and ./14. Yeah, so here you can see the loop has been executed. That is greater than equal to, if I will do, so it will run four times, I think. Let me just clear the screen. Okay, the 3 times I is greater than equal to 3. Okay, it will run only 3 times. Okay, I'm sorry for here, like condition will get true. Yeah, condition will get true here because it is equal to 3. So in this case, it will come out of the loop and there will be no further check. Okay, so it will print only 3 times. Okay, so now what I will do, we can print the table. Okay, so you can print the table of any number, like if you want to print the table of 5. Okay, so you can do like this. You can write the expression here, like whatever the expression you write, like dollar, let me just write for you. I will just dollar parenthesis, and you have to provide the number, that is the any number 5 into, and you will do like this dollar I, and here just do 0, and here you provide 10. Okay, and I hope it should run. So here you can see we will start with the 1. Okay, so let's check. So here you can see, and here we need to do 11. Okay, so here in this way you can print the table of any number. Also you can do your customized changes, like you can take input from the user and then passing that value here, and then give the result and the terminal. Okay, so I hope you liked it, guys, and you got to know about the anti loop. And I will post all the source codes of this particular video in our GitHub repository. You can access from there, and I will provide the link also in our description. Okay, so that's all for today's, and I will meet you in the next video. So thank you for watching. Bye bye. Now in this particular video, I'll be talking about the break and continue. Okay, so we will learn about these two keywords in our shell scripting. So let me first create the file with their name, like break and continue .sh. Okay, we are good to go. Let me add the shebang, because without this we cannot run our script. Okay, so now let me just tell you the execution, like what and what is this. So let me first talk about the break. Okay, so break is basically, it breaks the execution of a loop. Okay, so basically it breaks the execution of a loop, and continue is nothing but it skips the execution on some certain condition. Okay, so we will go and do the practical part of this. So break will basically, it will break the execution and it will not do the further operation, but in continue it will execute, but like it will skip that particular part. Okay, so let me just start with the for loop, because we will be using the for loop for the implementation break and continue, and also you can use while loop also, it's all upon you. So I will simply first demonstrate to you how the things works. Okay, so for this we will need to create one loop. So I'll be created for, so here I will do I equal to 0. I should be what you can say, I should be less than equal to 10. I plus plus, and I will simply right now I will just echo the value of I. Echo I. Okay, so now let me just add the certain permission for this 15. Okay, dot slash 15. Oh, sorry, yeah, so 1 to 10 the numbers are getting printed. Okay, from 0 to 10, sorry. So suppose in some condition you want, like if I is equal to 5, then after that your loop should not execute. Okay, so at this type of certain conditions you will execute from the loop. Okay, so how you can do it, you have to just provide the if condition like this. If dollar I is equal to some number, that is 5. So in this case, what you have to do, then you have to just break the loop, and what you can do else, you have to just echo this value of I. Okay, so you have to just save it. Okay, and I will run the loop here again. So I think I'm getting some kind of syntax error at line number 13. If then equal to 5. Yeah, we have not closed the if condition. Okay, so, clear the screen again. Okay, sorry, in else condition we are not writing anything right now. So now I will write fi here. And now you will get to know about how the things are working. So here you can see the loop is getting started from 0 and it is executing till 4. But when if your value of I is equal to 5, then in this case what is happening, your loop is not executing further. Okay, so similarly in case of continue we will see, and I hope you got it, like how the break condition works. Okay, suppose if you want to give some other number, like if you want to give 2, okay, so at that time your loop also will get break. Okay, so 2, save, and I will just run this script again. So here you can see 0 and 1 is only printed. Okay, so now we will talk about the continue. So I will just simply copy this loop and I will just here paste it, and I'll write like this here, comment out for you guys because you will need this code. Continue, and here I will use only the continue. Okay, so here what it will do, it will skip that particular part. Okay, if I run this loop again, so here you can see it has skipped 2. Okay, let me first clear the screen so that and I will just comment out this part because you should not get confused. Okay, so here you can see it has printed. Now you will see 2 is not getting printed. Okay, why? Because it is execute. Continue statement basically skips that particular part. Okay, so that's all about the break and continue. If you want like more example, let me just create like what we will do. We will just take the input for the user from the user in the for loop, and based on the user input we will break the statement. Okay, so I will just comment out this all also, and I will paste it here. And here what I will do, I will do read u input. Okay, and I will echo here enter your age, or here I can give the variable name age also. It okay, so here I will do if age is equal to or less than, we can say if age is less than 18, so then what we have to do, echo you are not allowed in party, like this. Okay, and else what we can do, else echo you are allowed in party. Okay, and here after printing this, we can just come out of the loop and you can use a break statement. Okay, so clear and again run the loop, and here it is showing enter your age. My age is suppose 23, so you are allowed in party. Okay, so again it is asking 34. Okay, so now if I'll enter 12, so here you can see you are not allowed in party and you came out of the loop. So that is the use case of the break statement to come out of the execution. Okay, so that's all for today's guide, and I hope you liked it. And if you have any queries, you can ask us in the comment section and you will get the whole source code in our GitHub repository. So that's all for today's, and I will meet you in the next video. Thank you for watching. Hello guys, now in this particular video we'll be automating the creation of files and directory using the for loop. Okay, so already we have learned about the for loop, how the things work. Okay, so let me first create the file using the 16 and automating file or dir creation and .sh. okay, I will add the hashbang or shebang, whatever you want to call. Okay, and let me tell you the use case first. So use case will be like this. You will be creating the one for loop. Okay, and using that you have to create files, okay, or directories. Okay, so this is the use case, simple use case. If you want to perform on your own, then that's a very good thing for you, like you will learn to know how the things work. And if not, I'm with you and I'll be writing the code along with you guys. Okay, so what do you have to do? You have to first of all take the input from the user, okay, like directory names. Or first I will create the loop for the directory creation. So I'll write the comment as like this. And what you have to do, you have to take the input from the user. Okay, so we have to do read dir name. I will write the directory name, dir name, and I will use the loop for I equal to 0 to I less than equal to 5. So suppose I have to create 6 directories, so I will use 5 directories. So I will use I less than equal to 4 and I plus plus. Okay, and here what you have to do, you have to create the directory. So how you can create it, using mkdir command, and you will provide simply the directory name. Okay, and if you want to add some 0 1 2 3 after this, so you can do like this also, like $i. Okay, so we will do that thing later, but now let's do this one. Okay, so here I'm just echo like enter the directory name which you want. Okay, control S to save. Again, we will need to give the particular permission to this file, that is the 16. Sorry, not 116. Clear the screen ./16. Enter the directory name. I need let's write the Linux underscore dir. And here you can see file exist. Why it's showing like this? File exist. Okay, Linux dir. Okay, yeah, it already exists. So we will need to add this one dollar I to create multiple directories. Okay, so I will just delete this. Okay, because you cannot have the same name, like you cannot have the two directories with same name. Okay, enter the directory name Linux dir. Okay, Linux dir, and here we go. So all the directories has been created, Linux dir 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so in this way you can create multiple directories we you want, like suppose in some cases we need some directory like test, so you can create this also, like you can write like this test, and again the directory will get created like test 0 1 2 3 4, all these things. Okay, so that's a very easy use case. So again, now let's create some files, but before that I will need to delete all those things because I don't want much files in my this directory. So I will delete this. So let me choose all those things and I will delete at a time. Okay, move to trash. Okay, it's this OS is running in virtual box, that's why it's slow, little bit slow. Okay bro, so what we can do, so we will now create the file creation script. Okay, so echo enter your file name. Okay, so here again I will use the same loop and read file name and all those things. So here I will do read file name or student name. Suppose there is some student list and you want to store their data in that particular list, so how you can do it, so you will need to use touch, and here I will start with the one. Okay, so let's clear the screen and just I will comment out these part because I don't want to create directory right now. Okay, I will simply run this script, enter your file name. So I will use a student like this, and all the file we get created like 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so I have not used here a student name variable, so I will need to delete all these things again. Sorry for that. Okay, delete it. And again, I will need to run this script here. So let me clear the screen. Run the script, enter the like this student. So here you will see like all the student 1, 2, 3, 4 has been created. So in this way, you can create 100 of files using the for loop, and that's a very good use case. Like suppose in some cases you need multiple directories, so you will not do manual tasks. Okay, whatever the amount you need, amount number of directory, you will just provide it here. Okay, the number of directory you need, and that's all for today, and I hope you liked it, this use case. Again, in our next video, we'll see some use cases, or we will move with some different topics. So that's all for today's guys, and I'll meet you in the next video. So thank you for watching, and I'll meet you next one. Thank you. Hello guys, now in this particular video, we'll be automating the user creation. Okay, so how we can do it? Let's start with the video, and I will create the file that is 17usercreation.sh. Okay. Just add the hash pang Okay, so let me first tell you the use case. Okay, what will the use case? So here the use case will be the for loop. First we want multiple users, and then username input, then password, and also choice whether user want to add user or not. Okay, so I will comment out this, and I will just create the for loop. First the loop will be I equal to 0, and I will just run this loop till less than equal to 2, and I plus plus. Okay, so here first I will take the input from the user. So I will first enter your choice. Okay, if choice is 1, then we will add a user, otherwise no. Read choice. Okay, so we will read choice, and we will apply the if condition here. If so one space here, if dollar choice hyphen eq, it means equal to 1, then what we have to do, then we have to take the username input, read username. So here I will do just echo enter the username. Okay, and next I will take the input echo enter the password, read password. Okay, so now till now we have like we will take the input from the user. Okay, so the command that we use to add the user, that is the user add. Then we will use sudo user add, and we will provide hyphen m hyphen a slash bin bash. Okay, and the username. So username is this one. In this we have stored a username, and then we will pass the password, because password takes the two parameters. Okay, so I will pass like this. Okay, so dollar username dollar password, and the pipe is pipe works because it passes the whatever the data is here, it passes this side. Okay, like it will pass the data to this command, that is sudo ch, and the ch password it is. So we will write ch password. Okay, so this command will add the password in the system. Okay, or for that user you can say. So now the else part will be else, just break out of the loop and close the if condition. Okay, I will just clear, and I will just add the permission dot slash 17. Enter your choice, my choice is 1. Enter username, I will enter like hello world, password Linux machine. Okay, so here you can see authentication. We are getting some kind of error, like user hello world. Okay, password not change, enter your choice. Let me just enter some other number to break out of the loop. Okay, let me check with the code again. So read choice, we are getting the choice. Enter the username, that is the read username, then read password, then sudo user add hyphen m hyphen s bin bash, and we have passed the username here. Okay, then echo username, and here you can see the password. Okay, we have, okay, there was a minor mistake. So again, let me just run the command. But before that, let me just delete that user, del user hello world, I think it was. Okay, done. So again, just run this script and enter your choice, my choice is 1, and username Ankit I will write, and password I will write hello world. Okay, so now it is asking me to again enter my choice whether I want to add a user or not. So I will know I don't want, so I will write 0. So we are out of the loop. Now I will log in into the Ankit and enter the password hello world. So here you can see who am I. If I will do so, it is Ankit. Okay, so in this way we can Like automate the user creation if you want to add multiple users. Suppose if you want to add only one user at a time, then you can use this commands. Okay, these much of a script, and you don't need any if condition and all those things. Okay, so in this way you can automate the user creation. I hope you liked it, and if you have any query, then please you can ask us in the comment section. So that's all for today's video, and I'll meet you in the next one. So thank you for watching. Hello guys, now in this particular video we will be learning about a test command. Okay, so before starting, let me first create the file that is 18 test command, you can write .sh. okay, so let me just add the hashbang. Okay, bin bash. Yeah, so before starting this particular tutorial, let me first tell you about the basic like description about the test command. So basically test command is basically used to test the particular expression, or particular condition. Okay, so if condition is true, then it will return 0, otherwise return 1. Okay, so if condition is true, it will return 0, or otherwise it will return 1. Okay, so it's basically like one of the another method of writing this expression. Like whatever we write in this if condition, whatever the expression we write here, whether 5 is equal to 5. Okay, so it just we can just replace these part using the test command. Okay, so but also there are many many functionalities or many options are being used with the test command. Like if we want to check whether two strings are equal, whether there is some file exist or not, whether the file is empty or not, whether the file or directory, like if we want to check whether some particular directory it is directory or not, or some mathematical operation like equal to, greater than, all those things. Okay, so we can do all those operations. So let's start. So first we will start with the string comparison, like whether two strings are equal or not, or not equal to, whether a string is empty or not, all those things we will do. So how we can do it, let me just create the two variables, that is A and B. So I'll write my name Ayush and B equal to Ayush in this, okay, double quotes. And now I will write the if condition, and I will use the test command, if test. So it is basically like what we can say, advised to use the double quote for the variable while using the test command. Okay, if $1 equal to $B, then what we have to do, then we will just echo A is equal to B. Okay, and I will just write the else all part also, else echo A is not equal to B. Okay, just close the if condition and clear the screen and chmod plus x 18 dot slash 18. Okay, so here you can see A is equal to B. Now what I do, if I just change the B. Okay, so here you can see A is not equal to B, it's equal. Okay, let me just clear the screen again and run the script. Yeah, so here you can see A is not equal to B. Okay, also test command offers many more functionalities, like string size if you want to get. Okay, so how we can do it, using hyphen n option. Okay, like not basically string size, it basically checks whether a string is what we can say, empty or not. Okay, so how we will do it, using test hyphen n $A we will use. So basically if there is some string, then it will echo string is not empty. Okay, empty, Okay, so hyphen n option is checks whether there is a string or not. If a string is not empty, then it will result true. It return true if it is not empty. Otherwise, it will return false. That it means a string is empty. Simple. So how you can do it? A string is empty. So we are checking a for a. So for a there is a string. So it should return a string is not empty. So a string is not empty. It is returning. If I will just pass hyphen b dollar b here. So it should return a string is empty. Okay. So it is returning my string is not empty. What is it returning? Let me just again run the script. Okay. It is also returning a string is not empty. So for this we use hyphen z option. Sorry for that. We will use hyphen z option here. So clear the screen. Okay, so again it is showing me the same thing. Okay, but okay, sorry. I'm sorry, here we have to use this double quotes. Okay, but still it is showing a string is not empty, but why it is empty? There is something wrong we have done here. Sorry. What we have to do here is string. This is empty string. So this condition is getting true and it is just displaying me this echo message. So that's wrong. If I do something else here, condition will get false. And then it will display me this. Okay, so there is nothing much. So we have to just replace this echo with our one. String is empty, or here we can just do string is not empty. Okay, so now it should return a string is not empty. So here you can see string is not empty. If I will just remove this part, it will display me a string is empty. Okay, so it was just if it is true then it will execute obviously. Okay, so in this way you can do a string comparisons also. So now moving forward in numerical part, what you can do if we want comparison like equal to, greater than, all those things. So how we can do it? Let's just do it. Okay, so I will just copy this much part and again I will paste it here and I will provide here some numbers like a equal to 10 and b equal to 20. And here if test hyphen, we will not provide hyphen here, we will use the same thing which we use for numerical like hyphen eq. So here I will use dollar a. Okay, if dollar a equal to dollar b. Okay, I will remove this one. So here if a equal to b, so it may here we will print a is equal to b if it is true, otherwise here we will just print not equal. Okay, just again clear the screen and run the command. So string is empty and not equal. Okay, so if I will do 10 here also, so in this case a is equal to b, or you can check other options like less than, lt for less than. Here I will just add one on more zero, that is 100, and clear the screen, run the script. Okay, so here we will just change the equal statement like a is greater than b, sorry, less than b. Okay, so clear the screen, again run the script. So a is less than b, that means it means this statement is true and this one is executing. And if I write here, so here we will see not less than b. So not less than b. So in this case you can use multiple things using test command, like you can play with the numerical part, string also. Okay, so instead of this double bracket, whatever we use in this one, like double bracket and spaces, so it is easy to use this one. Okay, So now moving forward, we will use some like file comparisons also. So how we can do it? Okay, so I will provide the file name, not file name. I will use these much of file or hello.txt to play with it. So there are multiple options which we can see, like hyphen s option, which is used for checking the what we can say, checking the if file is empty or not. Okay, so let's start with this. So here I will just add the command, that is the file comparisons. Okay, so here what we can do, if test hyphen s, and I will provide the file name, my file name is hello.txt, then if file is empty, hyphen s is used to check if file is empty or not, we will just echo file is empty. Otherwise, else echo file is not empty. It means if condition is true, then it will execute line number 32, and if not, it will execute line number 34. Okay, so I will just comment out all, otherwise leave it. Let's check. So let me first check the hello.txt. So in hello.txt there is nothing, so it should return file is empty. So we have got some kind of error. So the error is we have not closed the if condition. Clear the screen. So file is not empty, it is showing. Why? Because I don't know if file is empty or not. So the file is empty, it should display. Let me just create one more file, test1.txt. So it is absolutely empty file. So again here I will provide test1.txt. Clear the screen. So again it is displaying me file is not empty. Why so? Okay. Okay, if file is not empty, it will display this line. Okay, if file is empty, then it will display this line. Okay. So we have done some mistakes here. Like we have to just replace this line here. So I don't know why this thing is happening. So sorry for that. So just clear the screen, and yeah, file is empty now. So now what we'll do, we will just write some text here, and now it should display some like file is not empty here. So clear the screen, and again, so here you can see now it's showing file is not empty. Okay, so also there are many flags we can use, hyphen d and all those things. Okay, so there are many flags which we can use to check. Hyphen d is used for check, I think, whether the whatever you are passing, that is, it is directory or not. Okay, so I will create one directory, that is let's create one directory, that is dir1. Okay, so here I will just pass dir1. If it is directory, I will display if condition is get true, it's a directory, or it is not a directory, I will display here it is not our directory. Just run the script. Okay, so it is a directory, and I will provide some different name here. Like suppose I provide hello, what was the file name, that is test1.txt, and now it should display it is not a directory. So yeah, it's correct. Okay, so I hope you liked it, guys. We can use test command while providing the conditions in if conditions. So okay, so that's all for today's. I know there were some mistakes today, so sorry for that, and I will meet you in the next video. Okay, so thank you for watching. Hello guys, now in this particular video we will talk about functions. Okay, so what is function and how everything works? We will discuss all the things in this particular video. Okay, so actually already I have created this function.ss file for you. If you are not, then you can also create this one. Okay, so let me first discuss about the function. What is function, the basic idea about it? Like, if you are aware of any other programming language like C, C++, Java, Python, then you might be aware of the function, but if not, then let me tell you about this. Okay, how everything works. Okay, so what is a function? So the basic definition which everyone says is like, function is a block of code which can be used again and again. Okay, so as the name suggests, as the definition, so this is the same thing as like it. Okay, so whatever the code, if you write some kind of code and you want to use it again and again and again, then you can write that particular code inside a function. Okay, suppose you don't want to do some particular task repetitively. Okay, then you can use a function. Okay, suppose you have to sum two numbers. Okay, then you can create a function and then you will just call that function to add those numbers. Okay, so basically whatever the main benefit we get from the function is the code reusability. Okay, it means we can reuse that particular code again and again. This is the basic idea about the functions. Okay, so now let me tell you about the basic syntax. What is the basic syntax of the function in the cell scripting? So how we can do it? So basically the basic syntax is the function name, whatever the function name you want to provide. Okay, the double parenthesis and simply this curly braces, and inside that curly braces you have to just write the code. Okay, whatever the code or whatever the operation we want to perform. Okay, so this is the basic syntax which we will be using inside this whole tutorial. So now let me just create one function with the name greetings. Okay, and I will just echo something like good morning, good morning Ayush, like this. Okay, and to call the function you have to nothing, you have to just write the name of the function, greetings. Okay, and now let me just move into the this particular directory. Okay, and now what I will do, I will just provide a certain permission to the file chmod plus x 19 function.sh. okay, clear the screen, /19. okay, so here you can see good morning Ayush has been printed. Okay, so here what happens, suppose we want to again call that function, so we can just call it again here. What happened? Let me just copy it again. Greetings, paste it here. Okay, so again it will print good morning Ayush 2 times. Okay, why it happens? Because here you can see the name of the function, and we are just echo this thing, good morning Ayush, and then we are calling the function. Okay, so with function calling, whenever you call any function, then it calls this function, and whatever the code inside it, it gets executed. Okay, so this is the basic functionality of the functions. Okay, sorry, now moving forward, we need to talk about like a parameterized function and the returning value. Okay, so what is the parameterized function? Let me first discuss about you. So basically in function, what happened, you pass some parameters. Okay, and with on that parameters we do some kind of computation and all those things. So I will just create the sum function. Okay, I will just remove this thing and I will create now parameterized function. Okay, so the name of the function will be sum Ayush. Okay, and I will just echo the sum of $1 and $2 is not like this. Before the parameterized function, let me just discuss with the simple function how we will do it. Like, suppose if a equal to 12 and b equal to 13, then c equal to $a plus $b, and you have to just echo the value of c, echo the sum of $a and $b is we have to just echo dollar $c here. Okay, just save the code and we will just call the sum function, and then we will get the result as 25. Okay, so we have got some kind of error in line number. Sorry, we don't have to provide this parenthesis here. Okay, we are getting error, not error, the same string, because we have not added the expression in a right way. Okay, so here you can see for computation, like we know, like we need to do like this. Okay, then and only we can compute anything. Okay, so here you can see the sum of 12 and 13 is 25. So suppose if you want to change number, okay, so 13 and 14, so we can get now result as 27, I think. Yes, 27. So here the thing is, we need to change that thing in our this inside function, but what do we want to pass the value while calling the function? And in that case, we need the parameters. Okay, so how we can do it? So in cell scripting, we basically pass the parameters as this one, like from here we will pass suppose 12 and 13, and then it will act as the $1 and $2. Okay, so in this way we can get. So now for this, I will just provide a equal to $1 and b equal to $2. Okay, and all things will remain same, and I will just pass the parameter here 12 and 13, not 12 and 13. Let me provide just, okay, 12, and let me clear the screen and again this. So here you can see the sum of 12 and 12 is 24. Now we don't need to change anything in our function. We can do changes here. Okay, so now the answer will be different, like 167. Okay, so this is basically the parameterized function. Okay, so we can pass parameters inside the function, and then with those and the computation will happen on those particular parameters. Okay, so this is the basic functionality of the parameterized function. Let me just create some another function, like suppose you want to get name of a student, get a student name. I will create a function, get a student name. Okay, and I will just echo like this, name of a student is, and here I will just echo $1. Okay, so here whenever you will call that particular function and provide the name, so let me provide the name as Ayush and clear the screen. So here you can see name of student is Ayush. Okay, so in this way you can pass the parameters. Okay, so now let me discuss about you the return type of the function of in cell scripting, how this works. So basically in what we can say in cell scripting, the return, the like method of returning any value is some little bit of difference. So let me discuss it with you how it basically happens. Okay, so basically what happens whenever you call the function, and if you return something, then you need to store that return value in a special with a special symbol, we can say like that. Okay, so here if we want to echo and not echo, if you don't want to echo, you want to just return the value, so you have to just write return $c. okay, and after calling the function, you have to store the value return equal to, you have to write I think $?. So it basically stores the value whatever the returned. Okay, so if here the return value is there, like what basically happens, it will store the value before, like here the sum function. Okay, so if there is if it is returning some value, then it will store inside this variable return. Okay, RET. But if there is again some kind of any function, and here it is returning something, like suppose here I create some function. Okay, and here I write the function name as sub. Okay, and here the return type will be all the same thing, but here in this case, now what will happen, it will store the value of this return value. Okay, So this happens. So let me first, before going into complex thing, let me first discuss with the basic part how we can get the return value. So now you have to just echo the return. Echo return value is $RDT. Okay. So let me just clear the screen and I will just comment out this part. Okay. And let me run the script. So here you can see the return value is 67. Okay. So in this way you can store the return value. But now what happens if we just we do sub here, sub we do. Okay, so in this case let me check what happens. Okay, so in this case also we are getting the return value is 67. Okay, but we have not called the sub function. So let me first call the sub function. So sub, I will provide 13 and 14. Okay, not 13, 14, 13 and 12. And here I will write $a minus b. So value should be 1. Okay. So here you can see return value is 1. So and now what I will do, I will just call the sum function here before return. So now let me check what will be the return value. Return value will be now 167. Okay, so now I hope you got the idea about how the value is stored inside this RET variable. Okay, so whatever the function is calling before this, so that value is getting stored inside this variable. Okay. And whatever if some function is calling before this one, so that value will not be stored inside this. Okay, so this is the thing about return type of a value in a shell scripting. Okay, so that's all for today's guys, and I hope you liked it. I will update the source code in our GitHub repository. You can access that from access this code from there. Okay. And in our next video, we'll cover something more important, and that is about nested function. So we will discuss all those things about in the next video. So that's all for today. And if you have any query, you can ask us in the comment section. Thank you. Thank you for watching. Now in this video, we'll be talking about the nested function. Okay. So actually I have already created the file with the name 20_nested_function. Let me just paste the thing shebang. Okay. And now let me just discuss about the basic idea. What is the nested function? So it basically means, as the name suggests, you can guess, we will just calling function inside a function. Inside a function, not calling, also we can say we can write also function inside a function. Okay, so let me just discuss about the same thing. Suppose I create one function demo, and here I just echo something like this is a demo function. This is a demo function, and again I create one more function, that is the demo 2, and here I'm writing echo this is a this is a demo2 function. Okay, and now what will happen, I will simply call this function demo here. Okay, and demo2 below. Okay, so I will just give the permission for this file. Okay, clear the screen /20. Okay, now we are good to go. Here you can see both the function has been called. Okay, so this is the basic thing. Okay, but now what I will do, I will just call this function inside this function. Demo2. Okay, so now what will happen, it will basically call the function. Okay, so here what happens, the demo function has been called. So here it saw we have to echo, so it echoed this part, and again it check demo2 function is also called, so it gets the print the content of this demo2 function. So in this way this nested function works. But what if we want to call the if you want to write the function inside a function. So now here what I can do, I can just call this function here also, demo2, and clear the screen, and again we will get the same result. Okay, this is the demo2 function. Okay, so now what I will do, we will take the one use case of summation and addition, summation and subtraction, okay, and we will work on those things. Okay, so I hope you got the idea about how everything works. So let me just comment out these things, and I will create the parameterized function. That is, first I will create the sum, and here I will echo the sum of, and I will pass the $1 and $2 is, and here I will just do the computation part. That is the $1 plus $2. Okay, and let me first check whether the thing is working or not. Sum 2 and 4 and $20, and okay, yeah, it is working. The sum of 2 and 4 is 6. Okay, so now I will just create a sub function also here, and I will just echo the sum of the difference of $1 and $2 is, and here we will do the computation part. That is the $1 minus $2. Okay, and then we will just call the function inside the sum function, that is sub 4 and 2. Okay, so let me just clear the screen again and hit enter. So here you can see the sum of 4 and 2 is 2. Yeah, I have done something. Yeah, let me just give it proper space again, clear the screen, and yeah, we are good to go. Now here you can see the sum of 2 and 46. We have passed 2 and 4 here, and we are getting result from here, 2 and 46, and subtraction of 4 minus 2, that is equal to 2. So we are getting the exact result. Let me change the value, and I will write 80 here, 80, and here I will do 40. Okay, so here you can see we are getting the same result, like expected result we are getting. Okay, so in this way we can do the nested function and all those things. Okay, so I hope you liked it, and I hope you got the idea about how the nested function works. Okay, so that's all for today's video, guys, and I hope you liked it. And if you have any query, you can ask us in the comment section, and you will get all the source code in our GitHub repository, and you will get the link in the description. So thank you for watching, and I'll meet you in the next video. Thank you. Bye-bye. Now in this video, we will be talking about some basic and the important concept, that is the local variable and the global variable. Okay, so actually we have already covered the function, so that is very important to know about the concept of local variable and the global variable. So let me create the file with the name lvar and gvar. .sh, okay, and I'll just add the shebang here, bin bash. Okay, now we are good to go. So I will start with the basic definition of the local variable. So if you like, I will just write local variable. So we can define the local variable as the variable which is declared inside a function is called as local variable. Okay, sorry for mistakes. Okay, my typing is not good so much, that's why it is happening. So what is the local variable? So local variable, we can define it as like the variable which is declared inside a function, that is the local variable. Okay, so suppose if I am creating one variable, that is the function one. Okay, name of the function is function one, and I am defining a variable that is a equal to 20. Sorry, 10. So in this case, what is this? So a is nothing but the local variable. Okay, so if I will do echo a here, echo $a, and I will just call this function one, and let me just add certain permission to this file, that is the 21 clear /21. Okay, so now I will just run the script 21 underscore. Okay, so it's not okay, let me just again, yeah, clear the screen, /21. Now, okay, so here you can see we are getting the value as a value of a as a 10. Okay, so this is the local variable, like we have declared this variable inside a function so that we can access this inside this function only, not outside of this function. So if you want to print without function calling, okay, I will just print here echo dollar a. So let's see what happens. So it will, I don't think it will print anything. Clear the screen again. So here you can see we are not getting any kind of result here. Okay, so this is happening because we can't access the local variable outside of the function. So that is the thing we can get to know with this thing. Okay, so I will just commit out this and I will just again call this function. And now I will discuss about with the what is the global variable. Okay, so global, let me just write like this, global variable. Okay, so this is the variable which is declared outside the function. Okay, Joby, like whatever the variable which is declared outside the function, that is called as the global variable. Okay, I hope you got the idea. Okay, so let me just comment out these things and I will create the variable name as the gvar. Okay, gvar equal to 20. Okay, or I can just define this string like I am a global variable. Okay, so this variable can be accessed from anywhere of your program, like inside the function or outside the function. So if I will just call here echo dollar gvar. Okay, so here we can see the result as the I'm the global variable. Okay, so here we are getting the result, I'm a global variable. But now if you want to again echo the same thing inside the function also, so we can also get the result two times, like I'm a global variable. So here you can see 10 and then I'm a global variable. So you should see the like how the function is executing. Like when first what is happening, we are just printing this global variable and then we have called the function. So after calling the function, we are getting the first it is calling this local variable and then it is calling this one gvar, that is the global variable. Okay, so this is the simple concept of the local variable and the global variable. I have discussed why, because we have already covered the functions and this thing you should know about it. Okay, so that's all for today's guys, and I hope you liked it. And if you have any queries, you can ask in the comment section and I will post all these things in our GitHub repository. Okay, so thank you for watching and I'll meet you in the next video. Thank you. Hello guys, now in this particular video we'll be covering like one of the script, that is the user deletion script. Okay, so basically in this particular video we will use the whatever the thing which we have learned till now in our some previous videos, that is the functions and the global variable, local variable. Okay, these all things which we will be using inside our this particular video, and we will create the one script, that is the user deletion script. Okay, so let me create that file, that is the 22_userdeletion.sh. okay, and let me just add the what we can say hash call exclamation bin bash. Okay, we will add this shebang, and now let me just discuss with the workflow, what will be the workflow, because if you want to do the same thing separately on your own, then you can do it simply, because it will give you the more confidence about in this cell scripting. So let me just tell you what we are going to do in this particular video. So we will basically read the username, whatever the user which we want to delete, and we just need to provide our the system password for deleting the user and the del user command. Okay, so these are all things which we are going to do inside this particular video. So let me just comment out this thing, and now I will just use the local variable and the global variable concept and the function concept inside this video. Okay, so before deleting the user, we'll need to create a user. Okay, so how you can create the user, we will just use sudo user add, and let me just name it the test. Okay, Ayush@0098. okay, user has been added, I hope. Let me just check with the password. Okay, so here you can see test user has been added. We have not provided password and all those things because we don't want to create a normal user. We have to just delete this user, that's why. Okay, so the name of the user is our test. Okay, so first what I will do, I will just echo enter the username. Okay, and I will just read the username inside the variable read username. Okay, and then what I will do, I will just echo enter your password. It means it is asking me for the whenever we use sudo, then it asks me for entering my password. Okay, so that's why I have entered enter your password, and I will read here, read system password I can write, okay, or current user password you can write the variable name, okay, or the sudo or the root user password. Okay, and now I will just write the function name as the tell user. Okay, and inside this tell user I will just echo dollar this one system password. Okay, and I'm just passing this password inside the command, that is the sudo, using a pipe I will use, and I will use sudo hyphen s. Hyphen capital S is used whenever we take the input of the password from different sources, like we are getting we will write the password using this. Okay, and you, with the help of hyphen capital S, we can write the password, and then I will just write the command, that is the tell user and the username. Okay, dollar username. Okay, and then we will have to just call this script tell user. Okay, so here you can see these are the what global variables. Okay, these are the global variables. Okay, like username and the system password, and these global variables are being used inside this function. Okay, so this is the normal function, and here we are just what we are doing here, we are just calling the tell user function. Okay, and now what I will do, I will just move into this particular, clear the screen, and I will just need to give some permission to this file. Clear the screen /22. Okay, now name of the username is the test, and I will need to enter my password. Okay, so removing user test, so now done. So we have finally removed that particular user. If you want to go back and check the /etc password file, so there will be no test user. So as you can see, there is no test user. Okay, so in this way we can delete the user with our script. Okay, so we have just used the global variable concept, which we have learned in our previous video, and the function concept. Okay, and here we are just passing the name of our username which we want to delete, and hyphen s of hyphen capital S options to pass the like password. Okay, so this is the thing. I hope you got it, how everything is working. So that's all for today's video, and I'll meet you in the next video with some another script. Okay, so thank you guys for watching, and I'll meet you in the next video. Thank you. Hello guys, now in this particular video we'll be creating one of the script, that is the file integrity checker. That is the basically a simple script which we will be using to check the integrity of the file, whether the file has been changed or not. Okay, so basically for this tutorial we'll be using one of the tool, that is the md5 sum. Okay, so let me just show you the demonstration of this particular tool. So basically this tool will generate the hash of the particular file. So if you will check the hash of this hello.txt, so here you can see there, this is the hash. Okay, so but now if we'll change the something like let me add again 1d here, and again let me check the hash. So there will be change in both the hashes. So here you can see the difference. So basically what we'll be doing, so we'll be using this tool, and we'll be creating two functions for generating hash and checking hash, and we will check if both the hashes will match from the previous hash. Then there will be no changes, we will display that as an output, and if there is changes, then we will display output as like there is change in a file. Okay, so let's start with the creation of the script. So let me just add the one file, that is the file integrity checker, file integrity checker.sh. okay, so now what we will do, I will create two function. So let me just pin bash. Shebang has been added, and we will give the two options for the user for generating hash and the create checking hash. Okay, so but before this, I will just create the function that is the generate hash. Okay, and we will be covering all the concept which we have covered till now. Like mostly function will be covered in this particular video. Okay, so now I will just ask the user to enter the file name of which we want to generate hash. So here I will ask the user, enter the file name please. Okay, and I will just store the file name in the read file name variable. And then now what we will do, we will just generate the hash and store that hash into the file, that is md5 sum, and we will provide the file name, and we will just file name dot md5. We will store the output in the md5, this output, whatever the output we are getting, this one we will store in this md5. Okay, and then we will just echo hash value stored in dollar file name, whatever the file name we have, file name dot md5 file. Okay, so this is the generate hash. Let me just call the function and let me check whether everything is working fine or not. Clear the screen dot slash, but before that I will need to provide a certain permission to this file, that is chmod plus x, that is 23. Clear the screen dot slash 23, enter the file name. I will just write hello.txt here, and here you can see hello hash value is stored in this file. So let me check. Okay, so here hash value has been stored, we can check here. Okay, now coming back to the script, so let me just clear here, generate hash. Now what I will do, I will just what we can say, check hash value, will check hash value. Okay, and echo enter the file name. Now we are just checking the hash value, and we will match the hash value with our previous value. Okay, so echo enter the file name again. We will enter the file name, and we will just read file name. We are creating the variable and storing this in the file name, and now we will generated hash. We will create one variable value, generated hash. Okay, don't confuse between generate hash and generated hash. Okay, and here we will store the output of the previously whatever the previous hash which has been generated in the md5 file. So we will store the value, like this value we will store in this variable generated hash. How we can do it, we will just read the file name, that is dollar file name dot md5 we will add. Okay, and then we will again we will just store the like current hash or current output. So how we can do it, dollar, and we will just do md5 sum, and then we will just provide the file name. Okay, now we are good to go, and then we will use the if conditions here, like if we will just do like this, if, and we will pass the double quotes and dollar gen. Let me just copy this thing. If dollar generated hash will be equal to, we will use here equal to, again double quote, dollar output, then in this case what we have to do, then echo there is no change in file. Okay, and in the else condition we will surely add the echo statement, that is there is something change something change in a file. Okay, and then we have to just block the if condition. We have to just close the if condition. Okay, and now what we have to do, what we can do, now we will just echo the choices, echo one dot what the user want, generate hash, whether user want to generate hash or whether user want to calculate hash, to check file integrity, we can say file integrity. Okay, and then what we will do, we will use the switch case and whatever the thing which we have already learned. So we will use read hyphen p. Okay, and we will write enter your choice. Okay, and we will store it in the choice variable, that is the choice. Okay, and then we will use the case dollar choice. Okay, in, and if this is the, if this is one, then what we have to do, echo generating hash, and then we have to just call that function, that is the generate hash. Okay, here we go, generate hash. Okay, now we have to just remove this part. Now if 2 is selected by the user, then in this case what you have to do, and here you have to just break this one. Okay, 2, then we have to just echo, we can do checking file integrity. Okay, and we have to just call this function, that is the check hash value. Okay, and we have just closed this one, and the if any other value, that is the default, if we get the default, then in this case we have to just echo invalid choice buddy, invalid choice. Okay, and we have to close this case. Okay, now we are good to go. I hope everything is ready, and we will just run this script again, or clear the screen. Okay, and I will just remove this file here, because we will be using this file. Okay, and I will just remove this one also. Okay, now run this script. Okay, what is the choice? First, enter the file name, hello.txt. Okay, hash value has been stored inside this file. Now we will do, again run this script, and now we want to check file integrity. Enter the file name, hello.txt. Okay, so there is no change in file. Okay, but now what I will do, I will just again do hello.txt, and I will add this one e. Okay, and again I will clear the screen, again run the script, enter your choice, that is the second check file integrity, enter the file name hello.txt, and here you can see there is something change in a file. Okay, so in this case you can see we have changed the file here name, like we have added e, so it is showing me that there is something change in a file. So our this script is running actually fine. So for your if you want to go on some advanced level, you can use try except block, all those things. Okay, for if file doesn't exist, you can just pop up an error or echo the statement like file doesn't exist, all those kind of things. Okay, so that's all for today guys, and I hope you liked it, and we have used multiple things inside this. So this is basically the long script which we have entered till now. So that's all for today guys, and I will meet you in the next video. Thank you for watching. Now in this video we'll be creating one of the script, that is the cloning repository. Okay, so basically this script will, what it will do, it will basically clone the whatever the repository if you want to clone from the GitHub. So basically we will be doing in this particular script. So let me just create the file, that is the 24 clone repo .sh. okay, now we're good to go. We have to just so this is the basically a very simple script which we'll be doing right now. Okay, so the way to, let me just tell you the use case, how the thing will go. Basically we will read the link from the user. Okay, we will use the git command. Okay, and it will basically automatically create one of the folder inside our inside our system. Okay, so this is basically a simple use case which we'll be doing inside this particular video. So how we can do it, we use the concept of the local variable, global variable, and we will use the functions also. Okay, so how we can do it, if you want to do it on your own, then that is a very good thing. So now let me just echo enter the repository link. Okay, so we will ask the user to enter the repository link. So we will just read this thing inside the repo link variable. Okay, and I will create the function get repo, not like this, get repo. Okay, and to parentheses echo, and here I'll just echo getting repository, please wait, like this. And we can use the command git clone. Okay, and git clone and the repo link will provide. Okay, so now what I will do, we have to just call this script, call the function, sorry, get repo, and provide a certain permission to the script, chmod plus x24. Clear the screen /24. Okay, enter the repository link. So let me tell you, we will be repo what we can see, cloning this link, okay, or this repository cell scripting tutorial. So let me just go back here and control shift V, now enter. So as you can see, cloning repository, please wait. So it is done. So now here we can see all those file have been cloned here, okay, 1 to 10, because we have added only till 10. So let me just again delete this link. Okay, delete this directory, clear this screen. Okay, so this is the very simple script which we show right now. So now what we can do, we can check whether the user has entered link or not. Okay, so this thing we can do in our next video. Okay, like we will check about the regular expression and all those things, okay, in our next video. So that's all for today's guide, and I hope you in the next video I'll meet you. So thank you for watching. Hello guys, welcome back to the channel, this is Ayush, and now in this particular video we will learn about one more script, that we will create another script with the help of the nmap tool, which we basically use for the network WAM mapping, and we will look for the what are the open ports in the particular system using the IP address or the domain name. Okay, so but before moving forward in this particular video, I will talk about first about this clone repository sh file. So we can do one more thing in this particular script is like that, wait a minute, we can just add one more thing here, we can check for the whether user enters the correct URL or not. Okay, so we can use the concept of the substr, that is the substring, we will match the substring of a string. Okay, I hope you got the concept, this thing, what we will do, we will just match the substring part of the this repo link. Okay, if it matches with the github.com, then we can easily clone the repository. So now what we have to do, I will create the just another variable with the name domain name. Okay, so let me just create it, domain name equal to github.com. okay, and I will just need to add the some if else conditions here to check whether the user enters the correct link or not. Okay, so here I will just do $repo_link equal to, and I will need to use asterisk because we use that for the substring comparison. Okay, so I can do asterisk, and then inside the double quotes I have to just provide the variable name, that is the domain name. Okay, So now what we will do, we will basically like write the for the script, like then echo, if the link are equal, then what we will do, what is happening? Okay, let me just copy the same thing again here. Echo, then we will do this, else what we can do, else we will just echo please enter valid link, and we will close the condition part here with fee. Okay, so I hope everything is correct. So now what we will do, I will just run this script again here. So okay, I will run this script, but before that I will just copy this link. Okay, so just paste it here and the terminal. So I will just run this script using 24. Okay, clone.sh, enter the repository link. I will enter the link. Okay, so here you can see we got some kind of error. On which line we have got? Line number 14. Okay, if repo link equal to asterisk. Okay, we forgot to add space here. Control S, clear the screen. Okay, now I will just add first google.com, so it should show please enter valid link. Now I will, what I will do, I will just paste the repository link, enter. So here you can see it is cloning into cell scripting tutorial, and here you can see the directory has been created with the name cell scripting tutorial. So our script is running fine, because if you are entering some wrong URL, then at that time we are getting the this statement is running, like please enter valid link. So it means this thing is getting verified. Okay, so that was the part which was remaining in our previous video. So now what I will do, I will create one more script with the name sorry, let me just create it, 25 underscore nmap. Yeah, we can do nmap.sh. So now if you don't know about the nmap, so let me tell you first about what is this. So nmap is basically one tool that we use for the network mapping, or you can say like for finding the open ports in a particular system. Okay, so that is a basically a cybersecurity tool which we use for network scanning and all those things. We can also get the information about the OS. Okay, so just like other commands, like for ls we have l option, a option. So similarly for nmap also we have different options, okay, which we will learn in this particular video. Okay, so let's start with the scripting part, and let me just give you the use case how the thing will go on. So the thing is basically what you have to do, you have to read the host name. It basically means whether you want to take the domain name or the IP address. It all depends upon you, what do you want to take as an input from the user. So you have to take the host name, and then further what you have to do, you have to just use the nmap commands, okay, to just what we can say, to just scan that particular host name. Okay, so this is the simple use case which we will be going to use in this particular video. So for that, first I will need to enter the take the input from the user, that is the host name. Okay, so let me first clear the screen, and now I will just echo. Okay, wait a minute, what is happening, which key is I think some keys are, okay, wait a minute, some keys are pressed automatically. Wait a minute, yeah, I think now it's not happening, nothing is happening, sorry for that. So now what I will do, echo enter the host name. Okay, but before that, let me show you the how the thing is work. Okay, the actual thing works. Okay, so let me just search for the nmap. Okay, so you will get the official website of the nmap.org, that where it tells like it's a free and open source utility for network discovery and security auditing. Okay, so this is the basically one of the tool, and there is also one scanme.nmap.org. This is the what we can say testing website through which we can test for any for this domain name. Okay, like it's legal to test this domain name because they have already authorized peoples to test this particular domain, but you cannot test any other domain names without their permission. Okay, so if you do, I will not be responsible for that. I am clearing this thing in this particular video. Okay, so now let me just I think my internet is slow. Wait a minute. Okay, so now I've switched with another network. Okay, so now let's go on this particular website, nmap.org. So here you can see the whole documentation part. If you want to read, you can read. Okay, so let's go with the reference guide. You can go with this or docs also. So this is the reference guide. In this way we will basically write the command. Okay, hyphen a option is there. Okay, many options are there, and before that you should know about the TCP port, UDP port. Okay, so basically we have 65,536 ports in our system. Okay, so it basically scans which port are open in your system. Okay, so now let's move with the scanning part. Okay, so let me just check whether this website is accessible or not. I think it should be. Yeah, so here you can see go ahead and scan me is the title of this particular website. Okay, so now what we can do, we will just create this script and we will use this nmap tool and some other options. Okay, to run our script. Okay, so now let's do, so echo enter the host name, read host name. Okay, we will just read the host name, and now next what we will do, we will just take our password. Okay, the system password, because some of the options required sudo permissions, so for that we need this. Enter system password. Okay, so here you will learn one more thing. Hyphen fs option provides, like if you will enter something, it will not be visible. Okay, so that is the benefit of using this option. So here we can store with system password. Okay, and then what I will do, I will just create one function. Okay, or not function, before that I will need to create one function to work with the cases. Okay, I will just create different cases for different options. Okay, so how we can do it, so we have to just write the function name. So I will write the function name as the nmap function. Okay, like that I can write. Okay, and in this I have to just provide the some options. Okay, so how I can provide, like I will need to write echo dollar. Okay, and then I will just need to write like this. First option will be, or I can write like this, one dot and normal scan. Okay, and we will use slash n for new line, fair two dot, and then TCP scan. We'll be doing three types of scan in this particular video: normal scan, TCP, and the UDP scan. Okay, three is UDP scan. So these are the three options which will be available to the user. And then what I will do, we will we will take the input from the user. Okay, choose option which you want to prefer. Okay, so here we will just write the option. Okay, and now what I will need to do, I will need to write different cases. So if user enter one, what should happen? If user enters two, what should happen? All these cases I should write. So we have already covered it in our previous videos, so how you can deal with the cases. Okay, case option, in if one is provided, then what you have to do, I will just echo a thing like if one is provided, I should write like this, echo like this, normal scan. Okay, like this, we are done. And then what you will need to do, echo, I will just provide the system password to the sudo command. Okay, so so now what we will do, we will just pass the sudo and we will use the capital S, like hyphen F, S option, because we are getting the password from this particular system password. Okay, that's why we are using this option. And now we will simply use the nmap, and if you are going with the normal scan, so at that time we have to just provide the host name or the domain name. Okay, so we can just do like this, host name. Okay, so this is the first case which we will be dealing with that. And secondly, what we'll need to do, this is just like break statement, and for the second case, that will be for the TCP scan. Okay, so you can do like this, enter like this TCP scan, and this much dash. Okay, and same thing we have to do, just we have to change the option. Okay, so you can just copy and paste things easily, and hyphen S capital T, that option will be used for the TCP scan, and the third thing is just the UDP scan. Okay, so I know, yeah, you will not be aware of these TCP and UDP scan because that is the concept of the security part, but if you learn, you will surely get it. UDP scan, okay. And then again, same thing, I will just paste the thing here, and I will just use the SU, that is the one option which we use for the what we can say, UDP scan. Okay, so these are the three options, but if you use something else, then at that time what we will use the asterisk, and then we will provide please enter the valid option. Okay, so this is the case, and we have to just close this thing. So how we can do it, ESAC. Okay, and now simply we have to call that function, where it is, that nmap function. So I will just copy the thing here. Okay, call it here. Okay, now we are good to go. First we will need to provide the certain permission to that file. Okay, and now, so enter the host name. So our host name is this one, is scanme.nmap.org. okay, so it's all upon you. You can provide the IP address as well as the domain name. We will go with the domain name first, and after that we will go with the IP address. Sorry, we will need to provide like this, scanme.nmap.org. okay, you will need to enter the system password. Okay, so here we are getting some kind of error at line number 42. Okay, wait a minute. Oh, sorry, I have done some mistake. I have to just enter the name of the function. Okay, again, same thing, scanme.nmap.org. Okay, so what type of scan? I just want the normal scan. So let's check. It takes some time, so you will need to wait. And let's again check the IP of that particular domain name, scanme.nmap.org. Okay, so I think I'm not connected to the internet. Okay, sorry for that. Okay, so now I have solved the issue. So let's again run the script. Enter the host name, scanme.nmap.org. Okay, system password, normal scan I want. Okay, so it's starting. Okay, so here you can see we have got the different ports, like 2280 9929, these much ports we have got. Okay, so these are the ports which are open on that particular domain name. Okay, so also we can run for the second option. So again, run the same. Okay, second TCP scan. Okay, let's wait. These scans take, I think, much time. We will need to just wait. So basically in this script we have used switch cases and the function concept and the user input, all those things we have used here. So that was a quite type of revision for you guys, okay, if you will create these kind of scripts. So let's wait for this. It's taking a little bit more time. Let's wait. Okay, so we have got the all the TCP ports which are open on that particular domain name. So here you can see 2280 888, so these are the all ports we have got. So these are the open port, these are some filtered, open filtered. So you will if you will search about on Google like what is the difference between open and filtered port, you will surely get to know. And these are the services which you can see here. Okay, so that was the basic the thing about the scripting, like how we can use the different tools with bash script. Okay, so that was the tutorial for this, and I hope you liked it. If you have any query, you can write down in the comment section, and you will get the source code of this particular video in our GitHub repository. So that's all for this video, and I will meet you in the next one. Thank you so much for watching.